right now.
We are.
Hello, motherfuckers.
Hello.
Welcome to fucking Awesome Talk. We're here to once again wow your mind with our shit.
Ahoy.
Ahoy.
Ahoy. Ahoy.
Clinky to everybody out there.
And once again, as always, Awesome Talk is being brought to you by Nevermore Designs.
Nevermore Designs. And tonight we have an outstanding show for you. We have a roster. We have a roster. We have a bunch of shit coming tonight. We have the couple guys from Negative Traction coming tonight.
Yes.
They will be bringing Matt Clohosy with them, who's a local favorite. Yes. We have a local favorite.
Local favorite, Matt.
Did you say local flamer?
No, local favorite. We have poetry by Jacque Brown. She's going to be calling us from Louisiana. We have...
They still have sun there right now.
Yeah. There's sunlight out there right now.
I don't like that.
Dude, technology's gotten crazy. The sun's just up places.
It's all
the
time.
We fucking have some... footage from this past weekend's Ribfest. We have the beer cam.
Yes.
We have the water cam coming.
Yes, for those of you that don't know what Ribfest is, it is a...
It's a festival of ribs.
Yes, and beer and
our engineer just chased the cat out of the room. That was so funny. It's like he stole your wallet or something.
No,
I was like, what the fuck is he doing?
So, the end of the show tonight... Negative Traction is going to be debuting their new music video for their song WWZ, World War Z. So we're going to be closing the show with that. But we have a lot of shit. We are loosely prepared, more tightly than usual, though.
But still quite loose.
Tightly, but loosely.
Yes. Always got to be loose.
We like to be loose. We like to be light, tight, loose, and hard all at the same time. Yeah. Thank you for that.
Just a loose hardness.
Can't argue with that.
Ooh. Thank you for that. Now, Sarah, what were you talking about the NSA, not the NSA, whatever the fuck it was you were talking
something
about?
Sacramento,
Oakland, California.
Or Sacramento?
Oakland.
Oh, we're going to Oakland now.
We're going to Oakland.
Oh, they got a great record, too, when it comes to taking care of people.
They're pushing for a federally funded project to link surveillance cameras, license plate readers, gunshot detectors, Twitter feeds, alarm notifications, and other data into a unified situational awareness tool for law enforcement.
Situational awareness?
Yeah.
It sounds like a made-up
thing. Supposedly part of this has to do with that there's lots of things like riots and it's and there's a higher risk of terrorist attacks in that area, so that's why it's being targeted as a place to put this together.
Yes. Well, we'll never forget the day that the buildings fell in Oakland.
Well, yeah.
It will live forever in infamy.
Yeah. It's funny, it's funny that you mentioned
it. Oh, wait, nobody gives a fuck about Oakland. Not even the people who live in Oakland.
Well, what bothers me about this, a lot of things bother me about this, but what bothers me so much about this is the fact that no one is stopping to consider what causes the riots to begin with. Everybody wants to put a band-aid on everything. Nobody wants to fucking get to the root of any damn problem. That bothers me.
They
don't actually
want to riot this.
Yeah.
It will be a problem if it's being surveilled on Twitter.
They want to put a brick wall in front of a Mack truck instead of, oh, I don't know, finding out what fuels it.
It's a failed program in Manhattan. You know, they haven't linked as many things together as what you're talking about, but the situational awareness program has been in Manhattan for a while. And they say the percentage of crimes that have stopped is like almost nothing. It's a completely failed program.
It's another way to just funnel money out of everybody else's pockets into something that looks cool.
Yeah, well,
at this point in time,
I think it's, you know, even more so than that. It's just any foothold you can get to take away freedoms that you don't ever intend on giving back.
Yeah.
Why not start in a place like, oh, I'll bet you the voting rate in Oakland is practically nothing.
Well, if you want
to start there, you take it there. You say, oh, well, look at all the good work we're doing in Oakland, and you sell it to the people who actually give a fuck.
Yeah.
You know?
And for another example of this, in Newark, we all know how lovely Newark can be.
In Newark,
they fired... don't ask me if my numbers are correct, Sarah. I'm sure you can find them. But last year, they fired X number amount of firefighters and police officers in Newark because they said they had no money.
Right.
Then they spent ridiculous, like $2 million on a complete, like... camera surveillance system around the whole city.
Yeah, but that was federally funded.
So why don't they federally fund the lives of people who need jobs?
Because they say the federal government isn't responsible
Okay, wait a minute.
I understand your perspective. I understand your point.
The contradictions are so absolutely blatant.
Like, if the feds are supposed to stay out of people's livelihood, why in California are they breaking into marijuana dispensaries and kicking doors down and taking shit? Like, make up your fucking mind. Are you involved in the livelihood of the people, or are you not involved with the livelihood of the fucking people?
Well, because it's legally... it's legal for state, but it's still federally illegal. I mean...
Right.
So there's the conflict.
Okay, well, here's...
Which is a ridiculous conflict, because, like, when I had a medical marijuana license in Colorado, it's like, I'm not really breaking law, but I technically still am breaking the law.
But true.
Yes. Well, that's just the telltale sign of, all right, Dad said no, but Mom's cool.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly.
That's
like
what
that
comes down to. All right, Dad's gonna be a douchebag. Mom, can I buy a pack? Can you buy me a pack of smokes?
Right.
Cool. Thanks.
In North Carolina, they just passed a law to expand the rights of polling surveillance on voters, which is screwed up.
Explain what that means.
Way back when there was a lot more issues with race in this country.
Civil rights issues.
Civil rights issues. They used to have surveillance people that would intimidate people to come into the voting booths and things like that.
They did that during the Bush elections. They did that kind of shit.
But they've just, instead of contracting those laws, they've actually expanded the rights of polling surveillance.
Oh,
North Carolina. Yeah, that just happened. The same guy who passed that also said that he wasn't going to touch, like, when right before he was elected, they said, are you going to do anything to expand the abortion rights? Are you going to do anything, you know, to contract the abortion rights or anything with the laws with abortion in this state? And he said, nope, flat out. And then now he's made it so that 15 out of the 16 abortion clinics in North Carolina are going to be shut down. There's going to be one abortion clinic left in the entire state of North Carolina.
And I'll tell you what, it's going to be a shitty abortion clinic where they hire people who are fucking rude, nasty assholes. So when you walk in, they make everybody feel like shit and try to talk you out of it. So you walk the fuck out and don't do it. Guaranteed. Guaranteed it's how the fuck.
Either that or they're going to be really busy.
And this is a man. What's his name? What's the guy's name?
I
knew it was a guy, too.
Yeah, well, by the way.
I'm sorry, but my opinion on abortion, not that
I mean,
that's
I don't
what
care
we're
about names
about.
Too much. You know, I mean, he's an asshole.
No, the only reason I cared about names was because
if he was hung in the streets.
My opinion on abortion is this: I will never, ever be asked to carry a parasite for 9 months that's going to feed off of me. So I don't have a fucking opinion. My opinion is leave everybody the fuck alone. In fact, I feel that way about absolutely fucking everything. Just leave it. If what you are doing does not encroach on the freedoms or happiness of others, fuck off. I don't understand what people don't understand about this.
Because it's not. It's too much.
It's everybody in everybody else's face.
It's too much power for the individual to have. They don't want you making decisions. That's the point.
But I think
they'll put the steroids in your food. They'll fucking give you cancer and kill you slowly so that, by the way, they can make a few bucks off you on
the
way out. And they call that population control. And abortion is basically population control where you take the fucking time to make your own educated decision and say, I'm not ready for this, and the world is too goddamn crowded. But they don't want you thinking for yourself. They'll control the population.
Right, the
you just keep fucking breeding
right
and keep shitting them out. Don't worry, the new cancer we got brewing will take care of half your family in the next 20 years anyway.
But we can't advertise on food if it's a GMO or not. That's too much.
I don't want to know what kind of chemicals are put in my shit. That's you being smart. That's on the one hand, it's you making a choice. On the other hand, it's them making a choice for you, and they're gonna take that hand every time, no matter what it is.
We don't make a single, even the fuck, like, I see
that subliminal bullshit about our lives every, like, there are TV shows I like, and I'm sad to say I love How I Met Your Mother, but I watch How I Met Your Mother, I mean, I watch that all the time.
I'm sad to say, but
I'm not blind to the shit that I see. Like, if you watch Friends, if you watch How I Met Your Mother, if you watch Scrubs, you watch any of these these fucking network TV shows, they always glorify certain things. Like, marriage and having kids and getting a job and giving up on your dreams so you grow up. And they fucking pump that shit into your head so that you see it as normal. So that you go through your everyday life and you go, everybody's doing this. My TV said so.
Oh, yeah. That's the great Leave It to Beaver debate. You know what I mean?
Right.
The same shit, Brady Bunch, you know? Like, that's how they got here in the first place, was with those original shows. Like, Lassie, all that shit. You know, one to two kids, property, car in the garage. Right, right. This is what you want. This is how you do. If you don't do that, then you must be. There must be something wrong with you. You're not
crazy.
A real American. Yeah,
right,
you know?
Right, right.
Frozen the cat was staying
for. Except the Twilight Zone. Damn right. Damn right.
Frozen the cat was saying people are against abortion and birth control, but at the same time they complain about welfare. How does that make sense?
Right. Yeah.
Pro life. Because that's the same thing, you know. If it's under the guise of religion, oh, this is wrong morally, and this and that, and the other thing, then it's also wrong morally to let people starve, right? You know, I mean, that'd be the other side of that.
Exactly.
Corner,
right? That should be the simpler, number one issue on the planet. Should be everyone is entitled
to eat.
To eat,
yeah.
To have water,
yeah. I mean,
to fucking like, food. Why in the
water is
fuck?
We managed to get ourselves out of the food chain. Why are we fucking ourselves over like that?
In this bullshit monetary war.
The word water in some other languages is the word water is control.
Right.
In other languages.
Interesting.
Yeah, which is, you know, I mean, you,
what percentage of the human body's water?
Yeah, right.
90,
I look directly at Sarah.
92 or 95.
Yeah,
something crazy like that.
Yeah,
it's up there. It's fucking up there. It's
okay.
What's his name? Oh god, I can never remember his name.
The
Native American guy who he has a, you know, he's like the last remaining Cherokee or something, like one of the few last few Cherokees, and he constantly gives speeches like that where he's not really preaching though. He's just giving you. He's giving you facts before you had, like, just the way that people would say it before they could prove it. You know what I mean? Like, and that's what he would say, is stuff like that. You know what I mean? Like, your body is made up of mostly water, which means that you need water to survive. Why is the first thing that you do is contaminate water? You
right.
know what I mean? Like, when the right. Indians were here, they lived,
well,
they learned to live in harmony. Your body well, needs tree. Like, you breathe. What you breathe out. Trees breathe in. What trees breathe out, you breathe
here's,
in. Why are you cutting trees down?
Here's my argument.
You know what I mean? Like, what's wrong? You know, it sounds extremely, like, trite and hippie to a certain extent, but
it's
just the truth. It's science.
No,
but
here's
it's
my argument.
It's facts. You need these
that,
things.
That is the
and we,
equilibrium
and as fast
that we
as we can.
Race
as fast as we can. We're pissing in rivers.
I know
you're
not
trying
to make that. We don't need, you know, okay, granted, there's a very small percentage of water that we can consume in the world, right?
Right.
But the reality is that there are such thing as desalination plants.
Sure,
right?
Of course.
And,
yeah.
and most of the world is covered in water.
Sure.
And the technology is there to desalinate the water
right.
in order to provide water.
That's
to
true.
People.
Yeah, right.
We just don't invest in the infrastructure to desalinate the water to provide it to people
once
who don't
again,
have
why
water
not?
Contaminate.
Well, that's, but that's why
know,
they asked the
bigger
that's
issue.
Why they
I can
asked
answer
the question.
That question.
That's why,
I can
why
answer
he
that
asked
question
the
very,
question.
Very simply.
It's not
because
so
some
much.
Asshole decided to come up with a word and a term called infrastructure. And fuck everything up because he knew, all
right,
I'm going to throw these 8,000
right.
syllables together. You're all going to get confused and give me your money.
Yeah.
Ah, I win.
Well, the other problem is that you've
asshole.
Got, I was talking
right,
to this guy from Chicken Galore right after the hurricane. And he looks at me and he goes, I saw a picture of Asbury Park in 2012. He goes, it was next to a picture of Asbury Park in the 1950s. And he goes, a lot of differences have occurred. And he goes, you know what? What's exactly identically the same? This is when the power was out after the hurricane. He goes, all the fucking power lines are still there.
He it's goes, all the same infrastructure.
He goes,
right?
You mean to tell me
right.
we've come this far technologically,
yeah. oh.
but this is progress? Like, what the where?
Oh.
What is going on here? We don't need any of this shit anymore.
You're getting into a subject that I know.
You know, yeah, you know a lot about.
Yeah. No, but it's the truth. It's the
oh, wait,
truth.
Wait, Ken, before you make that point, I'm gonna back up for one second
sure.
before it gets too far away. You had said something earlier that I want to comment on. You were talking about shit sounding very hippie-ish.
Yes.
And I don't disagree with you that it comes off to people as hippie-ish, but that's what I'm talking about, subliminal things, like how dare you say peace and clean water, because then you get labeled with something that sounds negative.
Yeah.
Why is it negative to be fucking
no,
just intelligent
not.
And
not
honest
at all.
About everything?
John Lennon was shot.
Same thing
because
if you
message.
Say that the government is doing fucked up to you, then you're a conspiracy theorist.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh,
no.
God,
and
what
that's
a dirty
the problem.
Term.
That's the problem. That's
making sure that anything you have to say about it is insane and no one will fucking
Well,
listen.
That's the sad
right.
thing, though. If you don't double back and cover your statement with something like I just, you know what I mean? Like, it sounds hippie-ish, but it's fat. If in this day and age, if you don't make that oxymoronical, ridiculous statement, because
right.
you're just basically saying what you already said, just idiot-proofing it
right.
so that someone can't go, oh, he's just fucking hippie. No. He told you it sounds hippie-ish, but if that's the only thing that you pull out of it, then you're a moron. You know what I mean? Like, you actually have to stereotype yourself and your statements in this day and age to protect against people doing it to you automatically anyway. You know what I mean?
It's so easy to compartmentalize people. It's the only way that most Americans can handle. That's why there's Democrats and Republicans. Yeah. That's why there's Fox News or this news. Because there has to be compartmentalization for everything. There can't just be, oh, that makes sense and that doesn't. Right. It doesn't matter who said it.
Yeah. Johnny was going to say something.
Well, I was saying, like we were saying, like, people just automatically tag other people with stereotypes because everyone has been conditioned to all think and act the same.
Right.
And anyone who goes outside of that bubble is automatically labeled weird and
yeah. fascist or communist or
whatever kind of issue you want.
Right. Yeah.
Right. Which is crazy because that stems off of like the evolutionary aspect of humans. We're used to being. It's this weird oxymoronic thing where we are nomadic, but at the same time we're tribal. So everybody, our heritage is just random groups of people that don't really interact with other groups of people and wander about aimlessly. Yeah. But now nowhere to fucking wander.
It's illegal to wander.
Right, yeah. Sure.
They'll watch us wander.
They'll watch you wander and listen to every fucking thing you say.
And if we go hashtag wander, they're like, why are you hashtagging that?
Yeah, why are you wandering? Stay where you are.
Get out of Oakland!
Yeah. That kind of goes full circle to what you were talking about before with like all the bullshit and everything in TV and everything that's just not real, and now everyone wants like Friends.
Right.
Look at Friends. Look at all those shows. If me, him, and all of us lived together, and I went out with his girlfriend,
right?
Then they broke up. Went out with your girlfriend. And then, how many friends do you have?
I'd shoot you and then.
That's a clear case of murder suicide, right there.
I was best friends with a kid for 12 years. I said, what's up to us, girl? We had problems.
How dare you? How dare you verbally fuck your friend's girlfriend?
Our friends, everyone's banging, having babies.
That's just funny.
Yeah, that's true.
Swapping apartments. What the fuck?
None of that shit's real, but he's right. It's the Leave It to Beaver syndrome. Yeah. And that's why when Married with Children came out in the 80s, everyone was so damn thrilled.
Oh, they loved it.
Because it was the first show.
It was truth. It was reality. Yeah.
Then it was Fox.
It was closer
when
to...
When Fox first came out,
but
Fox
that's
was
always been the
edge.
Paradox with Fox. Yeah. Fox
no, that's
has been, you know...
That's why how they do
titties,
it.
Titties, titties sex,
that's
you
how
know,
they do it.
You,
hold on, but before
then,
we move on, before we talk about TV, I want to recognize something.
It's a good...
We didn't do a roll call.
Yes.
We do. For people watching, yo.
For the watchers at home.
Wait, let him finish his point, and then we'll take a roll call.
No, that was my point. We're good.
But no, I agree with you. Chiming in, I agree with you, though. That's one of the things that I hate about Fox so much, is because... It's kind of like if you look at what South Park does on Comedy Central and the limits that they're allowed to push. And then look at what the people are now. Fox, don't get me wrong, like Simpsons, Family Guy, a lot of those shows that they've put on in the past. What were we just talking about? Married with Children, you know what I mean? They push limits, but you can't. But that is a fraction of what they were wanted to do. Allowed anywhere near
the
guy. Exactly. Well, no, it's because Fox says no. You can go this far. They're not going to let them do anything to undermine anything that Fox can't spin.
This is why we have to fight for the internet.
Yeah,
that's right. That's right.
Anything that Fox can't spin and say, oh, it's just entertainment. Oh, you notice that there are never any real political messages. There are never any
real ones.
No, not at all. Like Family Guy, I think came closest during the Bush era. They would take every chance they could to put a tongue-in-cheek anti-Bush sentiment on their show, but it never out and out said it.
Fox was supporting Bush.
No, I know that. That's what I'm saying. Right. But Family Guy, like those guys, because they were employed by Fox, were never allowed to out and out just state their intent and do it. Meanwhile, I'm not calling comedy. They're corporate. They're conglomerates. They're probably owned by the same people. But the guys from South Park just threw the lines in the garbage, did whatever the hell they wanted, damn near got kicked off of TV.
But exactly what we're doing now is exactly the reason, you know, why this is important to do something like
that. My biggest fear is five years from now, we can't do this.
Oh, no, but that's what I'm saying. My original point was that's why I hate Fox, though, because it's actually brilliant. You put on the shows that even the shows, they disagree with you, but you don't let them say why.
You don't let them say why, so you nab ratings
and you evade the ability of people to be able to call you one-sided.
So,
in the same fell swoop, they just bought half of the fucking market that's against them and put it on TV on their fucking side, and they're making all the money off it, getting bigger and stronger, and at the same time removing deniability, you know what I mean? And saying, oh, I can, we're a fair and balanced medium. We put on Family Guy.
That's fair and balanced.
Yeah, exactly. Meanwhile, then listen to their news shows, and it couldn't be more one side. You know what I mean? That's how they do it. That's the trick. Subliminally, you can't hate Fox. They have Family Guy. You know what I mean? I mean, they're on the edge.
Let me ask you something.
They're on the cutting edge.
I want to ask you something specifically because I agree with you. Does it make you a little angry at Seth MacFarlane to go along?
Oh, well, not angry. I mean,
we lost Sarah.
Not angry, but
it's just out to protect us from terrorists.
Yes. Yeah, that's the problem.
This image, this television show has been censored for a better America. Oh, shit. You can't make this stuff up, man.
Fuck.
Well, we're still recording, though, so don't worry.
We're back on.
Okay, well, don't worry. Whatever segment you missed of the show, it will be on YouTube in the coming days.
We're all fools for saying anything at all anyway.
Yeah, that's all right. Don't worry.
Stop! I hate that it goes to my phone.
But anyway, sorry if we lost us there for a minute.
We're back. Sarah, are you there?
Hi, Sarah.
I don't know what the hell happened.
Fox. Yeah, thanks, Fox.
Shut us down.
Yeah.
Yep.
We're dealing with a little industrial espionage issue here.
Fox fucked us just then, I think.
No, it wasn't Fox. It was Seth.
God damn you, Seth!
He's like, why are you putting me in the middle of this shit?
I will not watch Family Guy for at least 1 week because of this.
When I get home from my midnight Family Guy fest, I'm not tuning in until the 12:30 episode.
Hey, Stewie, fuck you!
Little fucking prick.
Are we back on Justin TV, Sarah?
Sarah?
We're losing Sarah now.
Sarah? Sarah, no!
You there?
I'm here, but Justin TV is not on yet.
Oh shit.
Can you disconnect?
Well, hey, we're still recording.
Oh, that sucks. We had viewers.
It's all right. It'll come back.
Chatter.
The internet's back on. I don't know what the hell just happened.
According to Sarah, they were chatters.
They say we're sending up some comments and stuff.
Let me get some of that, Ken.
Yeah, you got it.
Yeah,
stay with us, folks.
I've been going back and forth in chat. But yeah, it's just a black screen as far
What's
as
that?
Well.
What
was disconnect and reconnect?
I did.
Okay.
I refreshed the page a bunch of times.
Sarah. Well,
try refreshing now. He just disconnected and reconnected. We should be there.
But it's a delay.
There's a delay, so it might take a few seconds.
It's like a 10-second delay.
It's that long,
a big delay.
It's long enough to get me a beer.
That's long enough to get you laid.
That's you?
Dude,
you didn't finish.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
Don't worry, Ryan. It was only 10 seconds because I was in you.
I am hideous.
I had to shamefully walk out of that.
Who's got a lighter?
I got one.
I want one of those.
Fire these motherfuckers up.
Actually, if you think about
it. Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you to the last broadcast.
See, that's
right. Uh-oh, there's the police.
We're back on?
There's Seth MacFarlane at the door.
One minute. I'm not positive. It's sort of frozen, and I'm not sure.
Uh-oh. This is disconcerting.
Yeah, it's just black.
I
My cousin said that it's really choppy.
Sorry for the choppiness.
So I'm guessing that
that's just because of the tide.
For me, it's just coming up black at the moment. For a second, there was a frozen image of Ryan, and then it was gone again.
It's probably native traction. It's not 30.
Actually, if you guys think about it, somebody could come in here right now, murder all of us.
Well, be on TV.
She would find out 10 seconds later. She would tell everyone in the chat room 50 seconds later, and then the whole thing would go out across the internet about 30 seconds later.
I was actually thinking something more simply. It blacks out, and then when it comes back, we're all smoking cigars like we just fucked each other in the dark.
Yep, we got it.
Sarah, are we back on yet?
That could happen,
it's
though.
It's choppy, pal. Cousin said it's probably all that beer false with.
Definitely are right with that. I can say that.
Andrew, are you hooked up to the internet?
Maybe.
Get off.
No, no, just, yeah.
No, I disconnected that.
Good. Shut down your whole computer.
I'll shut the fuck out of it.
By the way, I'll turn my light off.
I don't know why the hell.
It's like one frame every 15 seconds or so.
Wow.
Oh, well.
That's why I got him.
Oh well, fuck it. Going home.
We're still recording. That's what the backup, the contingency plan of that is YouTube.
Yeah. It's all right.
What's hey, up, gentlemen?
Hey, how's it going, man?
What's going on, guys? What's going on?
Hadley Hill, neighborino.
Brandon, Ian, Matt Clohosy are here.
What's up, dude? You got my letter.
What's up, man? How you doing, bro?
What's up, dude?
What's up, man? How you
good
doing?
Good to see you, man.
It's good. I got booze for you guys.
Yeah, it's good.
Feel at home, so we brought fucking 40 ounces.
Yeah.
There's
no talking.
Don't drink it, sir.
Shop right, friend. Real beer. All right. Good.
That's how we roll. Yeah, we brought the cucumber.
What's up, dude?
And Doritos.
How's everything?
Alright.
So are we back on yet? We're still recording.
Shit.
I don't know what happened, but we were having a conversation about Fox and the network. And out of nowhere, our entire internet went out. Like the whole internet to the entire building like went out.
You better not start talking shit about Malcolm.
Yeah, right.
Shut it down. Exactly.
Shut it down.
They heard us say Seth MacFarlane, and they were like, "Out for blood."
Sarah, can you tell the people in the chat room we know that there are issues, but we're working on it. Okay, thank you.
So the show is still going on.
The show's
it will
still
be rebroadcast.
The show's still being recorded. Okay, now it's time for a fucking roll call because there's a lot of people.
All right,
set
it off.
I'm Rick. Welcome to Awesome Talk.
I'm Ryan, as well. Welcome to Awesome Talk.
Stonz.
Brandon, Awesome Talk, first time.
Yes.
Yeah.
Matt, Awesome Talk,
first time as well.
What am I talking this way?
No.
All over
the camera. That one. Okay, right.
Yeah. I'm Ian,
everywhere.
And I'm taking calls now.
You're not even in the fucking shot.
He's everywhere.
I'm Andrew.
Andrew's in the back.
I'm in the back.
And as always, the engineer.
Up there.
The disembodied voice.
Mr. Matt Hill.
And I am Johnny. I'm Johnny Carta, JMC, all that.
Woo!
Yeah.
97 different names for good reasons.
Yeah, don't say all your names, dude. It'll take all fucking
Johnny,
shit.
Johnny Asshole, Scarpelli, Carter, Teflon.
We need content.
Listen.
Yeah, you're still getting about 20. Wait,
I brought
content
just
for 20 seconds.
Nice.
You got my request, thank you.
Yeah. I start out with actually a 12 pack and I wear one all the time so that when, like, one gets. When it gets raw, I slip one on so I can just like go throughout my day.
Just in case.
I used to know this guy used to carry him around in his book bag.
Yeah, exactly. Like in case I want to do a good deed, I visit a funeral home or something like that. Bad. There's like some crying grandma.
Yeah,
she needs someone.
You never know.
You might also have one.
You might see a guilt.
Yeah, exactly.
Because sharing is caring.
Sharing is caring.
You might find yourself being raped by a woman who's all sex nuts and retard strong.
But I hate it when they're retard strong.
Joe, the conversation you boys walked into had to do with subliminal messaging coming from television, okay? So we were talking about the Leave It to Beaver syndrome, where people stare at the TV and they receive messages on how to act in the everyday fucking world. And I think everybody in this room doesn't really fit the Leave It to Beaver mold.
That's what I think.
And we're all brainwashed to an extent. I mean, you know, take a bit more personal responsibility.
Yeah,
to our
I know for a fact I sure do love my money.
Right down to the fucking
dick.
I mean, right down to the show. We have to keep it. We have to keep the show within the boundaries of being of that brainwash bullshit.
Yeah.
You know, we always talk about, well, how do we structure this, right?
That's my least favorite saying, because it's the one thing everybody wants to do, but it's the one thing nobody can, is when people tell you, you can't fight City Hall. I hate that fucking saying, but it's so fucking true.
It's true. It's true, because you have to sort of submit to the way people believe you're supposed to be or supposed to act.
Well, that's why they have lawyers and shit like that. You can't just walk into a courtroom and say, this is bullshit, you guys are being assholes. You have to have some guy who gets paid $50,000 a minute to say it in a 10-sentence, you know, like fucking diatribe,
because
and go on.
Because for some reason,
you know,
it's rude to go up
because
to someone
it's rude,
and go,
yeah.
This is bullshit.
Yeah,
let's try to make some room at the
it's
bar.
It's rude
for
to
everybody.
Say it how it is.
Cool.
Who wants these mugs? Where do you get these mugs?
I got my Nevermore Designs.
I got
my flip it around.
Hell yeah, man!
That's our sponsor.
That's awesome. It is awesome. It's like actually three beers.
For a second, I thought that was
Clinky, everybody.
You're here.
Yeah. Okay, now before we go.
I love the root beer. Fantastic.
Hey, chin down.
I like the cucumber in the water.
Yeah, the cucumber water
sweet,
is
right?
Fantastic too.
Keeps it fresh.
I want to see this cucumber in the water.
Where I put this? I don't know.
It just looks like the dirtiest whore.
Oh, yeah. It totally is.
The cucumber in a big, wide cup of water.
That cucumber scene thing.
Yeah.
I feel like we were walking through the store before, and like everybody's just like, yeah. Like, mortified that this cucumber
well,
in the water.
Like, what is things like, hey, zucchini, like watermelon. It's like, obviously, it's not a watermelon. They're going to say what they did. Like, oh, it's in a fucking cup. This is mysterious.
What is that, a banana?
How many 30-second microwave episodes is that going to
get into it? Now, explain the cucumber in the water.
We were like at a coffee shop, and she was like, "You guys want water?" And we're like, "Yeah, we'll do some water." She's like, "You want some sliced up cucumbers?" Like, "No, I'm gonna want a whole one." I was like, "I go big or I go home." So she's like,
"We go home."
So, you know, so she's like, "Yeah, I'll just chop off the top." I was like, "No, I want a full cucumber.
No,
I'm leaving."
Stem
it
all.
So she just like threw it in here, and I've been kind of sipping on it.
And she picked through and
to find the perfect one.
Wow, like she looked
for
a good cucumber.
And I was just like, "Yeah, this is a winner, man."
Look, I would leave it to a chick to decide which cucumber's a winner.
Exactly.
Absolutely fantastic.
I would.
That's their job. It's still not up.
What's that?
No, it's still not up. Maybe it would be best to shut down your internet completely and restart it.
Okay.
He's going to put the show on.
Well, we're still recording. It's all right.
Keep talking.
Yeah. Recording and we do a YouTube stream, so I mean, you know, in a day or two it'll be on YouTube.
Who's
and anybody can watch it anyway.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. I don't have many talents.
But so yeah. Oh.
Sarah, how many viewers do we have?
Six.
Yes! Nice.
Woo! All
right. And they're looking at nothing right now. Thank you guys.
That's probably
your blind hope and faith that we'll come back.
Uh-oh.
It's probably.
Oh, shit. There goes Sarah.
Bye, Sarah.
She'll be back.
Who's Sarah?
Okay. Sarah
is awesome.
She does a website called spookymeat.com. We've known her for a while.
Yeah. She's got a Twitter feed.
It's called
Raging Science.
She is our Robin Quivers.
Yeah. She's the glue that holds it all together.
That's pretty cool.
When we start getting too ridiculous,
she
draws us back
to
reality a little bit.
She's what we like to call smart.
I really like the fact that you guys have like the space ghost thing going. Because I come in here, I'm like, there's the fucking head that's floating there. I was like, yeah. That's pretty sweet.
Yeah.
You
look good.
We talk about black holes. She reminds us about the facts.
Oh, yeah.
True.
Yeah, once we start going off a little bit, once you start reading us in with some actual documents and facts and stuff like that, we're, okay.
Unless you quote bullshit numbers, then she won't correct us. She's just going to bribe.
But she's a lot more believable than we are. Some people be like, there were 8,000 racists in that one street, and they all had automatic weapons. They were all shooting at each other, and she could just say, no, there were three people. They were protesting peacefully.
It changes the story.
It makes it
a lot less violent.
Well,
what?
The internet's still coming back.
Was Yoshi just born?
It's making offensive noises.
I was going to say,
you guys can work around my spot if you want.
Yeah.
Sarah,
I don't
want to
go near your
on.
Spot. God.
Well, we're still working on it.
Forward there, sir.
Slide aside.
There's a lot of gadgets going on.
Yeah, come on in, Andrew.
Not too much, man.
We need to get more stools.
Another day.
So If we get the internet back, people will actually be able to see it tonight.
I'm gonna give this up to somebody who has it because I was.
Everything should be back up.
There you go.
We still haven't gotten Sour Bash yet.
Do me a favor. Call Sarah on the video.
But like.
And hand me my beer. We're gonna walk there. Go. Thank you. Thank you, asshole.
Hey, yo, Mac, let me get some of that beer.
You gotta look into that.
Yeah. It's a horrifying movie.
Fancy as fuck. You want it in that cup?
Yeah, I
want
to put my zucchini in
there. Put the pickle in the mug.
Yeah, there we go.
Yeah, put it in the mug.
With beer.
Is it cool with that? Yeah.
Yeah.
With a root beer. It gets sketchier with root beer. It's just like, why is there a zucchini with root beer?
I did. I'm pushing the button.
It's not a zucchini. Just tap on it.
Yeah.
That's what she said.
Yeah, it doesn't care.
Just give it a little back there.
She does not want to.
Just ease it in gently.
Tap. They just fizz. They don't like it. It's like a bad reaction.
Yeah, no, it's trying to eat your zucchini. Now it's over.
That's a pretty hardest thing to like dissolve in there. So
it will.
Slivers.
It probably will, dude.
Because most caffeinated soda type beverages you shouldn't actually ingest because you can take rust off nails.
Yeah,
let's do it.
It's gonna happen.
All right, we're reconnecting. We're supposedly up back up on live on Awesome Talk.
All right, well,
are we?
All right,
well, all right. I'm cool with that.
We're allegedly live again. We have no way to confirm or deny this.
We're getting there. I don't know what the hell just happened. We tested the signal when Matt Hill got here before, and it was strong.
Oh, it was screaming. Yeah, it must have been that shit talking about Fox. Maybe.
That's what did it.
Dude, as soon as we started talking about that shit, everything went out. It was fucking crazy, dude.
Yeah, it hasn't happened. We've lost connection before,
but it's just like stop.
Actually, you guys want to be creeped out even more? Once we lost the internet, I got a phone call from a number I've never seen. I don't remember what the number was, but it ended in 1,000.
Really?
Weird.
Shit. Next is gonna be
2,000. Oh, and a voicemail. Yeah, it was 814-1000.
Oh, listen to the voicemail, dude.
It'll probably just be like, "Hey, did you like your vacation?"
We were just talking about you guys. My internet connection's coming in all fucked up.
Oh, no, that's actually a friend of mine talking about going to watch Mystery Science Theater 3000. I forgot he has an awesome number.
It almost turned into a creepy situation.
It was almost creepy, but it was just my buddy.
All right. Then that's different.
Yeah. It was terribly ironic.
I mean, it was the NSA. Yeah, they called
it. It was impeccable.
It was terrible.
As soon as we said, like, I think we said something about Seth MacFarlane selling his soul to the devil, and, like, you know, we were just like, soul to the damn devil, and the entire fucking box shuts off.
I can see Seth sitting in his bed, watching TV.
He's just like,
and he just sees
shit.
A little red light show up, and he knows that just means that someone somewhere is talking shit. And he just hits a little kill switch, and we just lose internet, because that's how powerful the creator of Family Guy is.
Is it still out?
It's resolving the problem. Hold on. Verifying.
Well, we're still on.
Yeah, well, we're still recording.
Yeah,
we're on. So you need. How's the zucchini looking? Starting to soak up the juices.
I think it's doing all right.
It's okay. It's got a thick. It's got a thick skin.
Soak that thing
soggy. You know what?
I'll
be ready for me later.
Yeah, no, it's gonna be gone. Dude, he's been taking his time with that thing, too. He doesn't want it to go.
Either it's going to dissolve or it's going to wind up in somebody's anus.
It soaks it up more inside.
We could do that. I'll take a chomp out of it and try to get to
it.
He
just had like a fucking entire fucking fucked up cartoon that just played out through my head.
Yes.
You didn't even
I'm not going to lie. That was a little arousing.
No, let's pickle that fucker.
Even the chomping part?
Pickle that fucker.
Oh, a frog. Oh, I like that.
Right. Yeah, man,
I love
he's
the
fucking son
look
himself.
On that motherfucker's
yeah,
face.
He's just like, shit,
fuck
I got
you.
This.
Why do you like the rain?
Listen, my godson, you're a human. You think I could fit you under this leaf? Fuck off. Stop looking at my groin.
Supposedly, hey, Matt Hill.
Last week, that was the most impressive thing I've ever seen.
Nope, you have to smoke that outside.
Yeah.
What'd you say?
Yeah.
My computer is telling me I'm fully connected, but my Skype won't connect.
He's protecting everyone from the rain. It was an interesting concept.
What in
the
fuck?
Wait, where is this turtle that we almost kicked?
He's in the corner.
Yeah, he's back here.
Turtle is Brandon said, like, we could potentially kill a turtle.
Yeah, so you gotta be careful.
They were really specific directions. I was just like, that was
tough thing.
I gave you scientific directions.
Not kick the turtle.
Brandon said that we had to follow these to a T. I'm just like...
Yeah,
we got here like 9:15, and he's like, all right, let's go. And I was
we're back.
I want specific directions.
I don't know what the hell happened.
There we are. The VR camera.
Hold on.
All right, the B train is here.
Sarah, I think we're back.
Okay. Are we good?
Hopefully.
How's the Awesome Talk feed? Is it better now?
Give me 1 second.
Sure. We disconnected and reconnected everything.
Yeah, we unplugged it all and plugged it back in.
And apparently, according to my computer, the signal is once again powerful as fuck.
We called India and they told us to do that.
Yeah.
Sarah, did you ever...
Let's be blue to your router.
Sarah, did you have a wardrobe change?
I'm not Lady fucking Gaga.
I was just going to say Lady
Every
Gaga.
Every segment she just changes a shirt.
Yeah.
Just like in the color or like a pigtail.
Ooh. Every time Sarah tunes back in, her hair is fucking different.
Yeah. She's got all teased 80s style, so you get the good
thing. She has a feathered Farrah Fawcett
but
style
yet,
for one
cut. I just have mascara down my cheeks, and I'll be fucked up with blood all
green shit. You're all
stoked out
of your mind.
Yep. Borrowing someone's cocaine. Someone's.
No one here
does
cocaine.
It's just a black screen for me.
Much.
Oh, no.
I swear to God, dude.
That's a bold statement.
I can't get it out of my Like, I want to make a fucking cartoon. Where, like, on Veggie Tales, the tomato tells the cucumber not to do cocaine, or this is all happened to
it. This is what happens to
That shit is cracking me up.
Just,
I love
it. It'll
be
a black screen, and then a frozen shot will come up once every 10 or 15 seconds, and that's all you get.
That's
still
Seth
happening.
Is less pissed at us than he was before.
Yeah. People have been texting me that too, that like sound is choppy.
Yeah.
Even the audio is just super chopped up. You can't
I need to get fucking Cablevision back in here. They fucked up everything. Cablevision, fuck you! They were here last week to fix the problem.
They're gonna
fix.
Turn your shit off. Maybe it wasn't Fox, maybe it was Cablevision. They were like, blame it
on
someone else.
Who owns Cablevision?
How many of you guys are running the stream simultaneously?
Who's friends with
Ted
Turner?
That's a good point.
You see?
Are they all rolling the same?
Everybody.
You guys really need to lower that down.
Anybody who's got a phone that's connected to my internet, disconnect from my internet.
I'm not connected. I turned my Wi-Fi off.
Your internet has a password.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, good point.
I can't connect to yours anywhere. I turn my Wi-Fi off every time I come.
I don't connect to your internet because I know how awful it is now.
How many viewers do we have at the moment?
How many viewers do we have?
At the moment.
Still six?
Still
yeah.
six.
That's
all right. Thank you. Probably the same
six
people
there.
That loyal six people. The same six people that hung out while we weren't here.
They
want to
see how it ends.
Sarah, are those viewers or followers?
Viewers.
We have
They're waiting
followers.
For the camera to come on after SEAL Team 6 clears out and all of our voices are all over the place.
This room is clear.
You may resume broadcasting.
And on episode 3, we all bleed slowly to death.
Yeah, right.
From the gunshot wound in our left lung.
I'm looking forward to that.
It's not my right lung, that's my good lung.
Well, okay, so, look, anyway, we're recording the show. The show is going to be on
well,
YouTube.
Let me have my dream.
Moving right along. What are one of the other topics that we were going to talk about awesomely?
Fuck that slight hiccup.
Fuck that.
I did.
So should I just tell the chat that there's
Tell the chat that we're working on it.
And... We're sorry.
And
it's being resolved.
Sorry. It's
no, but
being
tell
resolved.
Them. Tell them to keep chatting because we will address their questions on here, and it's going to be rebroadcast on YouTube.
Yes.
So I mean, no reason to bail out.
It's being resolved by Ted Turner as we speak.
Yeah, right.
He's working diligently.
We're on the phone with top minds.
We're taking calls now.
Cablevision is not a top mind. Believe
top
you me.
Minds.
Top.
men.
They are the bottom feeders of thinking. Like, even the fucking guy who came here and worked on it, right? Really nice guy. He was great. He fucking was like, your internet connection is powerful from one room, but in the other room, it's non-existent. You stay hooked up to that, your internet connection will be phenomenal. Well,
let's fuck off 101.
Yeah. And he was like, I'm going to talk to my supervisor, and we're going to get in here and rewire the whole thing, and we're going to call you.
Yeah, you know
that
what?
Was a week and a half ago. How many fucking called me?
You know how many times people that work for me say that they're going to come talk to me about a customer issue, and then they don't talk to me, and then 2 months later, the customer comes in flipping out at me?
Yeah.
That's just the way that works. Oh, yeah, I'll talk to my boss. Sure, is he gone? Cool. I'm going on break. Later.
I'm sure it's fairly simple. They must be nice people over there. You just call them up and be like, listen, I have an anti-authoritarian podcast to run here, okay? Exactly. Would you please come back here and help me undermine authority?
If you help me do this, hopefully within a few years, the seeds will be planted and you won't have to work for a living and we'll still be doing it.
But this is unacceptable. I mean, we got to air again in 2 weeks. This needs to be fucking resolved immediately.
All we have to tell them is that
I'm sick of them telling me it works.
We have more than six viewers, and we're going to tell everybody.
We have 10 now.
That they
there's apparently nine.
Up to more viewers.
Supervision in Denver, and my shit would go out every fucking time it rained, and they told me, we'll come out, but if we don't find a problem, you have to pay for us coming out. And I said, well, how the fuck do I know unless you come out, you asshole?
Wait, hold on, like coming out of the closet or just coming out to see you?
Both.
Both. I would not pay someone to come out. That's their job.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Like, if you want to tell me
bitches about
yeah,
it, then
I mean, unless I'm like asking for sexual favors, then sure, I'll pay. But I'm not paying much. Like, maybe does a nickel cover it?
Right.
What does a nickel buy these days?
High five.
You can have
a single stick.
Juicy fruit. One single stick.
Stonz will give you everything for a nickel.
Because he's easy. And if you tell him it's a quarter, you can't see it.
I know who I'm calling and yelling at tomorrow morning.
I hope it's not
they've been here three fucking times. When's
you
enough
can make
enough?
That shit part of the show.
Huh?
You should record it.
Have the guy fucking come in.
Them telling me the feed is awesome.
Hello, fucking Cablevision. You're on Awesome Talk, and we have a complaint.
Yeah,
you
a fucking massive complaint.
We're realizing how awful you are.
No. I purposely had it done when I had it done, scheduled it when I scheduled it to make sure this would fucking work.
And when you're on blast, Cablevision.
Right.
I'm so sick of this shit. I'm going to Verizon. Fuck you, motherfucker.
Yeah. Fuck you, Cablevision.
It really is. I hate that company, but goddamn it, they have a great product. I can't fucking deny it. I've been.
If you get BIOS, you'll get a new line to the apartment.
Yeah. That might be the best thing.
The company sucks, the customer service is abysmal, but goddamn it, the product is fantastic. I can't lie about it. I fucking hate that
what
company.
What the fuck is this?
Holy shit. You'll never be without internet or your cable or whatever. It'll be there locked.
I'm on camera doing the job that I do the best.
Hey, listen, while we're at it, we should tell JCP not to go fuck themselves, too.
Yeah, well, actually, they can go fuck themselves.
Yeah.
Actually, funny story about fucking JCP.
I'm behind.
Let's hear it.
So, my house is fucking 10 feet away from the fucking major, like, power plant for JCP&L.
Right.
And when we had Hurricane Katrina, they put on every other fucking town. They put on
Wall.
Was
it Katrina?
That was San Francisco. Oh, sorry. You know what? I suffered, too. Doesn't matter what she's called. She's a bitch.
Nature is a cunt rag. Yeah. You name her whatever you want. I'm going to call her Hurricane Cunt. Whatever it is.
She was my Katrina.
Yeah.
My Russian princess.
No, I agree with that, dude. We lost power. I lost power here for 15 days.
They said 15
days. Go fuck yourself.
But I don't have hookup power. That's the only reason why I didn't.
The power plant was right by my fucking house, and if they turned that on first, we would have power for like two blocks down, and that was the only two places that we had fucking left. They had Wall, Spring Lake, fucking Manis went up way before us, and then we're still sitting there in the cold, and they're like, oh, we're working on it. It's right fucking down the street. You can walk over and be like, it's on.
Not to mention, look out the fucking window at the power plant and no one is fucking there.
Exactly.
You're like, who are you bullshitting here?
I called them every day. I was like, hey, are you going to fix that shit? And they're like, we're going to work on it. I was like,
oh, well,
that was fucking
Christy, too. I mean, like, with the fucking, I can't tell you when I was out doing the construction aspect of it and, like, trying to dig people out and, you know, do all that fucking bullshit.
I can't tell you how many of the fucking people from other states came and were sitting in fucking parking lots and power trucks with nothing to do.
Here's the thing.
Because they didn't want,
just,
you know.
Just to straighten things out, it wasn't the line workers that were the problem. It was the fact that the material wasn't here.
Don't blame the line workers for it.
I'm not blaming the workers.
Hey, dude, that comes down from somewhere. So you're on the clock. You're on the clock. You don't make the call when it's time to go and do the job. Somebody else makes that call. Yeah, but they were all here. The workers were here. I saw them sitting there drinking coffee, waiting to fucking go.
They wanted to go. Yeah, I was one of them at one time. You know, I was a line worker, but I, you know, in construction, you want to move. You don't want to sit.
No, you know, it doesn't. Nobody makes money and nothing gets fixed.
Right. Well, I'm gonna blame Christy because he got too obsessed with the fucking Doritos Los Tacos. He's like, we can't fix this shit. Somewhere else has power.
How about that fucking commercial with that lame ass fucking song? That shit pisses me off so much.
Yeah.
Not by my fucking memory. The way I remember it, that storm pretty much kicked our fucking ass in one punch, knocked us out. We're stronger than the storm, my fucking ass.
That's bullshit.
We proved to be incredibly weaker than the storm.
And Mother Nature is just asking to be fucked.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. Yeah.
That's like saying,
exactly, hey, stronger than the storm. Like, don't fucking say that. The ocean's gonna hear you, motherfucker.
I would never go out to a hurricane and say, come at me, bro.
That's probably why they're fucking.
It reminds me of what's his name, Lieutenant. Is that all you got? You call this a storm?
Yeah, see, no, I was in my apartment going, that's all I need. Go! Get the fuck out! Leave me alone! That, I don't want anymore.
That storm was intense, man. I've lived here my whole life and lived through a million nasty-ass fucking hurricanes, and I swear to God, man, that was the only time where you would hear a gust of wind come in from like a mile away, and I swear to God, I know it was futile, I know it was ridiculous, I probably looked like a fucking moron, I was pushing against the walls.
please don't fall down, you shall not pass,
I'm gonna stop you somehow.
That was the first act of nature terrifying. That told me to drink half a bottle of scotch against my will,
because
I started thinking to myself, fuck it, if shit's gonna start throwing,
why would I ever be
hammered? I don't want to feel the tree branch impaling my body.
I did the same thing whenever I was in the bathroom and I heard that gust of wind. I put my arms
out. Yeah, right? Yeah, you just like grabbed something. It was like being on a fucking ship.
What was the other hurricane the year before called?
Irene.
Hurricane Irene. Katrina. I fell asleep on the couch.
Katrina, yeah.
I had a TV on over there. I wake up because my TV is beeping really loud and it says a tornado has been reported in your area.
I remember that.
I jump up off the couch with my feet and I go, so what the fuck do I do? What do I do? Huddle with all my cats in the bathroom?
I think that's when you're supposed to get in the doorway and stand there. You know?
Yeah, a doorway is going to protect me from the
earthquake.
You should just know.
No, wait, you need to get down to the storm cellar immediately.
No,
get in the basement. Get in the basement, Rick.
We've learned this from several different instructional videos. What you do is you get in a ball under the desk and you
and
wait.
Cry.
For the
you cry for hours.
You wait for it to pass as the lava passes over you and all kinds of fucking crazy shit.
Yes. Get into a fetal position and accept your fate.
Get under the desk. You'll be fine. No, it's not. It's atomic bomb. It's volcanoes. It's tornadoes. It's Satan himself coming up to rape you. Whatever it is. Whatever it is. Under the desk. Whimper like a girl. You're good.
Has the speed improved?
That's how you keep a marriage.
Mm-hmm.
You're whimpering.
They tell you if the plane's going down, just put your...
That's alright, dude. We'll fuck it. It'll be on YouTube.
I know it will, but it just...
No, what you do is you pisses me off.
We'll just have to super share. We'll have to super share it this week, and we'll get like as many hits on YouTube as we possibly can.
No, and that's correct. You're right, and that's the correct way to look at it. But when you tell people to tune in and watch it, it's not there. And it's not your goddamn fault.
All we can do is put the message up. I mean, if we can get a screen or something, you know, unfortunately. That's another thing we need to do. We need to get a graphic.
I think we need a commercial.
We need the technical difficulties graphic.
What the fuck?
Just
a
bird
or something.
There's a cat on my head.
Ow!
That means you
help.
I don't even want to see the cat.
It's a big cat, man.
I mean, no, it's a big cat. It's on your face.
Oh, you got to remember. By the way, Jane is...
You're lucky. Jane is a sweetheart. Now, if you'd have put Jimbo on you, you'd be in some trouble.
You would need to
take your hand clean off.
Yeah.
And I would probably blame you for it.
Jimbo would draw blood.
You would possibly need a new arm.
I do need a new arm.
I blame you too.
Matt Hill.
Take it clean off.
We gotta work on boosting the internet signal in here.
Fios. You gotta call him, man.
Fios, I can't, yeah, you know, dude. What? I can't get Verizon because I owe them fucking money.
Ah.
There's nothing I can do to fix this.
Oh, no, I know, yeah, there's nothing, yeah, you can do to
some
fix this.
Some kind of rain dance here.
I'm just saying, this is fucking insane.
It sucks, I know, but...
How much so we're just recording.
What? To my, my tower, and then everybody gets a copy, and we just... You know, finalize it, send, yeah, it up to YouTube. It usually takes about a day and a half, something like that.
The feed on YouTube,
we're perfecting
be
it more, and the feed, yeah, on YouTube is flawless. It looks great when you put it on YouTube.
And there's a few views on YouTube too. You know?
There's a lot.
Oh yeah, a lot of people check out the YouTube as well. So I mean, the YouTube
views
is actually probably where we get more of the fucking views from than anything. You know,
Sarah,
what I mean?
Can you issue, like, another apology on the chat room and just say,
I've
hey,
been
many,
many
did. They're on there. They're on there. People get it.
Man, no, people understand the fact that it's not like we have a Hollywood studio that we're recording this out of. This is out of our fucking apartment.
What?
It's a Hollywood studio.
Yeah, but it's
oh, yeah, it's the best Hollywood studio fucking ever.
It's
got booze and Doritos and shit.
I know, right?
Oh, yeah.
Cigars.
I told them to redirect all complaints to Cablevision.
No, the, yeah, the complaint to Cablevision is going to be mighty.
You just want to bathe in it, man.
He just sees the Doritos logo and he starts getting all kinds of
out of control. Yeah, man, I asked him for an M&M one night and he was like, fuck you. No, you can't have any. Let me get in at those Doritos.
What do you think, M&M's grow on trees?
Andrew's passionate about his junk foods.
I'm passionate about anything I eat.
Well, look, fuck it. Who cares?
No, hell yeah, we still got 40 ounces.
They took a couple minutes, but somebody finally threw
we
up.
We still got hooch. We still got conversation. We still got cameras. Fuck it.
Thank you, everybody.
To YouTube.
To YouTube.
Enter the Doritos.
Enter the cucumber.
Enter the cucumber.
Enter the cucumber.
And the fuck you, Seth MacFarlane.
And negative traction.
And negative traction.
Hell yeah.
We suck.
And Sarah.
My balls itch.
Let's talk about
my balls itch too.
Let's talk about negative traction. I want you guys to talk about your band a little bit. I want you guys to talk about how long you've been together, what's going on, what you want to promote. What kind of music would you call it?
All right, well, let's start there. There's a bunch of different ways we can call our music. I personally like to pick hardcore punk.
Okay.
Just because, I mean, we have a bunch of different backgrounds. We all started as metal kids. Ian kind of transferred into punk, and he got fat and chunky.
Because it's territory.
Yeah. Because punk does that.
Goddamn punk rock.
Yeah, exactly. But I like to think that the rest of the band kind of adds like that hardcore element.
Okay.
But then again, like, you could also say we're just like heavy rock. Maybe we're just like heavy punk. It's like whatever. As long as people enjoy our shit, then that's all that really matters.
We're like, I think that the way that
Ian,
I
think you should come over here
is,
so they can see.
Is a good spot because there's a camera right in his grill.
I'll switch.
I keep looking at that one.
We have like
no, that's just Sarah.
Very like,
hi Sarah.
Weird, you know, drunk rock type thing going on. It's like, you know,
favorite kind of
rock. We have like very like,
it's like party rock, stoner rock, but with a punk rock.
It's like, you know, I would like, it started off as like, I'm like the only one that really used in the band because the other guys were sober. But, you know, so.
It's extremely funny. Everybody else is sober.
Yeah.
You're straight.
He's straight.
I'm straight edge.
With your root beer and shit.
With my
root beer. Hardcore, man.
But, BAM! Yeah, I take my pants off more than anyone. I'm surprised. There's this fucking website I recently found out.
That's an addiction in and of itself.
That's true. I found out recently that there's this thing called You Got Posted, and I'm so mad I'm not on it. Like, I've
When is You Got Posted?
It's like some like thing you send.
Yeah.
Like when you send pictures to other people and they get mad and they're like, I hate you, and then they post it on You Got Posted, and there's no way to get it down. And I can't tell you how many times I've sent my wiener to everyone.
Yeah, we literally just like, as like the band, we'll just like mass text our, each other's junks to each other.
Oh,
so,
fantastic.
Yeah,
you guys
like,
gotta run for political office.
I know.
It sucks when it's friendly fire.
No, but What are the last names?
Mine and his?
Mm-hmm.
Dizwankowski and Egloff.
Neither one of those are any sort of inflections towards Dome. So.
Yeah, exactly. You can't really...
That ship has sailed, man.
Even though, like, a lot of the members are sober, we still have, like, really crazy.
We have crazy parties. Yeah.
I've been to your show, and it's your show is parties fucking hard.
We go, it's
shit,
hard. Yeah,
we try to go as hard as we can.
I believe the show that we saw them on there was porno getting not really distributed so much as shredded up and thrown everywhere. That was a good time. Yeah.
It's by the way, Twine did that in the '90s.
The box of free shit. I went around for like
a week. So we'll steal a 90s term. We were biters.
Yeah.
We were biters.
We had like our, what was it, our second show to play at the Stone Pony that we finally got booked.
Yeah.
And I went around for a week with this little, I stole a fucking like plastic box from like the audio room at my high school that they used to hold records and stuff like that. And I just like had people help me graffiti it, and we wrote box of free shit, and the first thing I put in was my old retainer when I was a kid. And then we just put porno magazines, condoms, cigarettes, all kinds of shit, and we went to our show and just started throwing it out. And you just saw all these underage kids with like Playboy, like they weren't even listening to the music anymore. They're just sitting on the fucking, like people are standing there with all this fucking crap that we found on the side of the road.
Your guys' show was awesome, man. The last time I saw you guys, you guys were fucking fun, man.
That was a good time.
It's been a while. Like the last time I think I saw you guys was at the Stone Pony with like End of an Era.
That was Independence Day.
Yes, that was Independence Day.
Yeah.
By the way,
I also want to point out
we played the outside stage
that night. That was the first.
The Stone Pony is just a bunch of
anybody who doesn't just stand there and kind of go through the motions and do the thing. Anybody who actually tries to ramp it up and have fun, the first guy who gets on your ass is the sound guy, and then you got nothing but trouble after that.
Oh, of course. I think we like put our hands out to cheer one time. They're like, "Shit, get him! No, put it down! Put it down!"
That bothers me about the fucking scene, you know what I mean? Like the music scene, especially at a local level, the music scene is the last, really, next to drug dealing, is the last dirty fucking business there is.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, it really is. And it's fucking filthy. Like, by the way, I'm not going to call anybody out. If you charge for parking after what you charge for tickets, fuck
dick move.
You.
Dick move.
If you're going to charge me to park in your dirt fucking parking lot.
I know exactly who you're talking about.
That's like, fuck yourself.
That's like a hooker charging you $50 for a blowjob, and then she's like, oh, well, I cut the balls. That's another $10.
No, exactly. That's like a hooker charging you for the condom.
That's just fucked.
And overpricing you for it.
But that's saying that all the amusement parks are just as dirty as the music parks.
Yeah, they are dirty.
That's the reason why I don't go to
amusement parks. I'm not saying you're wrong. I'm saying that, but that's the same exact.
I say the same fucking thing every time I drive to Asbury Park.
Careful, look at his face. The Gooch looks like he got punched in the fucking...
No, it's because he scratches himself.
No, I know.
He's got brain problems.
No, last week I was here, he looked fantastic. It like flares up week by week. That cat is...
All right. Every time I go to Asbury Park to go to an event or just go... Like today, me and my girlfriend went there to walk on a boardwalk, and I got to pay for parking. No, I'm like, do you or don't you want me to come here and spend money in your town? Do you or don't you want me to do that? Because paying me to force me to pay to park there is really fucking stupid. Like, I think it's absolutely criminal to pay. How the fuck else am I supposed to get there?
It's there because of all the criminals who spent the money that they did have.
Please clarify. Because criminal means politician.
Yes, no, exactly. Of course.
And the political, the way politics sucked the money out of Asbury Park in the last 10 years is disturbing and disgusting.
Oh, it's still going on.
Not nearly as bad as that guy Convince did. What Convince did was tragic to Asbury Park.
What?
The developer?
The developer.
Fucking.
Before the state took over, he was taking bribes out of
that,
the trailer.
That was the most beautiful fucking. That was the most beautifully ironic thing ever. Is remember when they're gonna build the new fucking high rise, but first, you know what? Damn it, we're gonna take down that old abandoned fucking parking garage. We're gonna blow it up, we're gonna implode it, knock it down, we're getting rid of it, and we're gonna build something nice and new there, you know what I mean? So what do they do?
There.
They fucking fist all this money, half the town shows up to watch them blow the place up.
It was
like this huge fucking thing. And then what do? They build the exact same structure, the exact same frame up, nothing but a skeleton, and then they bounce and take their money and leave it there.
Yeah. But
unbelievable.
There's another side to that. The other side to that is the fact that the developers got caught in the same economic cycle that they did back in the 70s when they first started putting the original structure. And that those developers actually took a huge loss on the middle of that project.
I'm sure they did, but they also were like crooked as shit, and they were fucking embezzling most of them. Maybe if they had, had the money that was given to them to start the project and finish it instead of spending it and hoping that they made more money, it would not be the exact same structure standing there, you know, the exact same skeleton. That's why I thought it was ironic. It was beautiful. They knocked it down to build it right back up the exact same way, just a couple of floors shorter.
But that ended in what, 2007, 2008?
Yeah, that's true.
That's when the crash happened, you know. I mean, so they lost all their... Everybody who was funny...
It's almost as if they knew it was coming.
Right. Yeah. Well, everybody that was in the real estate market knew that they were feeding into a machine. Everybody
absolutely, yeah. They've acknowledged it even to this point. A lot of people who got busted have come out and said, dude, it was a fucking set. It was a scam. It was a mail-in. Everybody knew that that shit wasn't going to hold up, you know? That fucking fictitious booming market that we experienced right before.
It was
bullshit. It was a way for them to get the fucking cash before everything hit the fucking proverbial fan, you know?
Yeah.
And unfortunately, Asbury was fully invested, you know, like fully. Every fucking block of the city was fully invested with some other fucking developer and shit.
The only person who said it wasn't a bubble was the ex-head of the Fed. I forget names.
Not Bernanke, the guy that...
The guy before Bernanke.
The guy that hired
me. the guy before Bernanke.
Scumbag.
That's all sweaty, dude.
Oh, well. Anyway, back to negative traction.
So, speaking of punk rock, how did we get from punk rock to the
Hall of Fame? It happens every time.
How
it
happens all the fucking
time.
It's
a natural evolution.
But to answer the other questions, we've been a band for, I want to say, about 3 years now.
Okay.
I've been playing music with him since I was 15 years old.
That sounds familiar.
Yeah.
It all starts like that. And obviously we had our differences on a bunch of shit. And I don't know, one day it just kind of came to a conclusion, like, we should start something and actually take it serious. Like, this isn't a fucking 15-year-old dream anymore. Like,
right.
Let's just do something, take it, have fun, take it somewhat serious, and just make people...
You're with Fred, right? I think you're, like, playing with... this bass player, Fred, they asked me to play. Started some shit. It was like more metal, like hardcore, not really punk, which is cool. It's cool as fuck.
Yeah, dude, everything's good.
And
we made like 20 songs or something like that. Yeah, and then we just fucking scrapped them all.
And then, I went to rehab for a little bit. Wrote awesome songs.
Hell yeah.
Came back, and then we like formed this, and like we got like a band together in like a week. We got the
Stone
Pony.
Yeah, we had a show in like 2 weeks.
And then we had to like find a bass player and then another vocalist because we're trying to do like punk rock with hip hop and shit.
Nice.
And that was our thing for a little bit.
Very cool.
It was fun. It was cool. It was different from, because I was in Morbid Visions, you know, I started that with a whole bunch of other
people.
Yeah. It was like, you know, that was like the only band that was kind of successful other than
Sunday
this,
afternoons at the Saint with Morbid Visions.
Yeah.
Every Sunday.
That actually sounds kind of like fulfilling. Like, Sunday afternoons with Morbid.
With Morbid Visions.
Morbid Visions.
But this weekend we'll be working on crochet.
Why are bass players so hard to find?
Really? I feel like the hardest to find is like drummers and guitar players at this point.
Yeah.
Good guitar players and good drummers.
Good guitar players.
You know,
I don't know why the fuck I'm here then.
Yeah. The drummers that I grew up with, and the reason why I didn't start by playing bass was bass players are a dime a dozen.
Yeah. No, that's not true at all. Bass players are most. I've always found.
Yeah, we had a revolving bass player door for quite some time.
I'm number four.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah. Number four. The longest running one too, I think.
Yeah. Well.
Well, technically.
I mean, Tommy's at the position, because Scott was the bass player for a while.
Was Scott the bass player for a while?
Yeah. No, I'm not.
He's excellent, too.
Did you guys switch out some members from End of an Era or something like that?
No. When we stopped, Scott went and played with them, but outside of that,
Scott's
I don't think
guitar.
So.
Yeah, I remember playing guitar. And actually, Justin, from when he was playing with End of an Era, he actually filled in for our bass player at the Starland Ballroom once.
Yeah, him and Steve, right?
We're stealing some of the piss chips.
I know, so I remember Steve.
No, I think it was maybe, but I just remember Justin. And he was excellent, too. It was great.
Yeah,
it was great.
I'm going to shit fire.
What do you think? Dude, shut the fuck up!
I'm fucking talking about shit and fire back here.
What do you guys like to listen to? What influences you?
Everything.
Yeah. Honestly, it's.
I said the same thing, but
we're almost.
If you were to get in your car right now and put something on that you had to listen to, what would it be?
Christina Aguilera.
Of course.
No, I mean, it's yeah, but I mean, like, I...
You were ready for that guy.
Me and him actually... I knew. Like, me and him actually listened to a variety of different shit. He's more well-rounded on, like, the punk and hardcore background, and I'm more well-rounded on, like, the...
Shitty in metal.
The shitty in metal. But I also know, like, the pop. I know all the rock. Like, you never know when you're going to need it.
Biggie Smalls.
Yeah, and he knows some like hip hop and stuff. So
yeah,
like,
yeah, exactly.
We're together. We're pretty much well rounded on just about everything. And if we're not, then I don't give a
that's
fuck.
A good viewpoint. Like, no, that's a good viewpoint to have though, because I think that's all the lamest bands I've ever seen were the ones who stuck strictly to the gimmick.
Yeah,
you know what
yeah.
I mean? I can't just. I loved a lot of that. Like, actually, their earlier stuff, I was kind of like, yeah, that's cool, you know. And then when Hanneman, you know, R.I.P. or whatever, when Hanneman started taking over a lot of the writing and they started doing the thrash shit like Diabolus and Musica and all that stuff.
That was
when I was like, dude, this shit blew my head off. Bands is like, I think all my favorite bands move in arcs, you know what I mean? Like, there's like a very few that can stick to the same formula and be successful, and but like still bring you albums that you really, really want to listen to.
Oh, of course,
I think everybody has to evolve a little bit, you know what I mean? And I like the ones who start drawing in a little bit of this and a little.
I was like, Fleet and Mac.
All right, I'm going to stop everybody for just a second. Right now, what we're going to do is I would like to show the video from this weekend's Ribfest that some of us attended. Once we come back from that, we're going to talk to Jacque Brown from Louisiana. She's going to have a poem that she wants to say that has it's called Regarding Trayvon Martin. We're going to have her on first for a couple of minutes. But yeah. So watch Ribfest, enjoy beer cam, water cam, all that shit, and we'll be back in a little while. We know the Justin TV feed is fucked up. We know it's Cablevision's fault, and they will be hearing from me in the fucking morning.
And that's why everybody thanks their lucky stars for YouTube.
Well, thanks, YouTube. Thank you for YouTube. YouTube is going to have this show on real fast this week.
Yeah, we're gonna step it up.
Thank you for all the advertisements, YouTube.
It's going to be youtube.com/user/homebarproductions. Okay, we still got a lot of show here for you, but right now, enjoy the Ribfest cam, if maybe by some fucking chance it actually goes through like it's supposed to.
Talk, conversation, debates, bullshit, situational humor, argumentative discourse, opinionated nonsense, special sauce. We are not held responsible for our opinions, actions, or suggestions. That's Awesome Talk, brewed by Homebar Productions. Yo.
So this is my television, and it's telling me all that I needed to know. And I won't deny all the times that I tried to defy all your facts with a fiction I load. My world on my back is so much more disgusting. I wasted my time, tried so hard to trust. A lie, contortion, so to distortion, it had me convinced I belong on this road. And these people can't see the threat of fact from the fiction. They don't know the lines between facts and fiction. I will become all the things you despise. And these people can't see the thread of fact from the fiction. They don't know the lines between happiness and destruction. I'll tear you down from all of your lies. Yeah.
and pop all your god pills. You'll never be as protected as mine. We live in this shit, man, we build all this shit. And conventional weapons will not let us die. Red in my head, I have moments of truth that speak through commercials and sell me the end. I speak.
See, it's gonna start with the nipple ring, and then it's gonna fade out to my ugly, horrifying face.
Wait, what's that for?
I'm gonna record myself falling into the pool.
You're falling into the pool!
I'm gonna fall into the pool!
But why do you have a camera?
Look at all the little shitheads over there. Yeah, there they are. What? No, no, no. See, you're gonna do a slow-mo shot of this.
His stance on it, and he said no, but he asked him if he would write an autograph to his kids, and Ian McKellen said yes, and then on the fucking paper he wrote, fuck off, I'm gay.
Okay, so in a couple of minutes we're going to hear from Jacque Brown, who's going to call from Louisiana, who has a really great poem put together called Regarding Trayvon Martin. For now, right now, we're still sitting with Negative Traction. Talk about some shows you guys have coming up.
We actually have a lot of really good shows coming up. We have a show this Friday, actually, at The Fix in Red Bank. It's free, no tickets. You just show up, you fucking party, pull your wiener out, whatever you want to do.
do that. Make sure that we get the wieners.
Make sure the wieners come out. But it's a really cool idea. So it's this Friday, and then we have a show.
Stardog.
Yeah, we're opening up for Stardog Champion, which is actually the ex-bassist and guitarist of Breaking Benjamin.
Okay.
And that is the 9th. So it's not this Friday, but it's next Friday. And then we have the Casualties coming up. We're opening up for them. We're opening up for Calibres again.
That's a big one, dude.
Yeah,
that
should be a good one.
The Casualties going to be a good one. Yeah. The last time we fucking played with Calibres, that was one of our best shows we've ever played.
Yeah,
Calibres, they're all really fun guys to play with, too.
Yeah. We have a lot of...
And the dates will be up on our Facebook, Negative Traction, at facebook.com.
Yeah,
whatever you want to do.
We're
you
also in the process of making a website. We have that going on.
Yeah, we have a website going on. We did do a music video. Unfortunately, I didn't tell you about this yet. It did get leaked out of my hands.
It happens.
But it hasn't really been viewed by that many people. Okay. I would still like to say that the official viewing would be done on Awesome Talk, because it would be that much better.
I'm said this YouTube video will be up within 36 hours.
That's
dude.
Cool.
Normally, cool. Normally I wait till the end of the weekend, but because this shit got fucked up the way... Is it coming in smoother at all? Or is it still fucked up?
Let me check, but I don't think so. My cousin said she likes this show. It's dark like her soul, which means that it's just a black screen.
Perfect.
Yeah, there's nothing but a black screen. Nothing. And every once in a while, you'll get, like, one frozen image.
Okay, so Cablevision's going to get...
All right, Cablevision's going to get fucked.
Idiots.
But it's going to be on YouTube, so... yeah, so we have those shows coming up, and we're pretty excited about them.
Good.
We like to say that we get excited for every show, but...
What about you guys? You guys kind of, you guys are doing your recording and stuff right now, right?
When you say you guys, you mean Twine, right?
Yeah, I mean Twine.
Yeah.
Twine, well, our Kickstarter failed miserably.
That's what I just heard.
Which I was kind of, I don't know, like, I was surprised and not surprised, you know? Like, I'm kind of used to things not working out properly.
Okay.
But, I'm also completely understanding of the fact that our
you
fan
said
base
failed miserably. How much did you raise?
$2,700.
That's you know, that's a lot.
That's like over a quarter.
Yeah, but we don't get that.
But you say it's a huge failure. There was enough people out there to get you up to $2,700 to just give you their money. You know what I mean? How could you say that's a huge failure? To me, that's not a huge failure.
So your optimism is something I'm cherishing right now. And
optimism is sickening.
I didn't fucking get it.
This is mine. I mean, you're right. I mean, I think it shows. I mean, I have a lot of people who wanted to donate but couldn't and said they wished I could have extended.
Yeah, and you were off the scene for how long?
Four and a half years.
4.5 years,
I mean,
you were off
the
scene
shows
and
you
raised $2,700.
Look, I'm not the guy you got to tell this to. You got to tell it to Ryan when he comes
in. But I'm saying that's not,
because
you know,
Ryan needs to hear this. Is he coming in right now? They're talking about the possibility why there won't be another Twine show. They're talking about.
Oh yeah, what? Who was talking?
I mean,
about?
I mean, well, I don't think anyone ever said there couldn't or wouldn't ever.
Is this
be
one mine or is this one mine?
I think this one's yours.
That one's yours.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. All right. The lighter.
Mine.
And this is
no.
Give me a lighter.
There's a lot of reasons for that, but
that's,
I don't
the main
know.
Reason.
You know, everybody's
all the lighters.
Everybody, you know, we've all got a lot of things going on. And it's
it's not that it can't happen again.
It's not,
like,
not that it can't.
Like, I feel like a Twine Negative Traction show would be a great fucking show.
No,
I feel like
it would be
your
cool.
Fans remind me of our type of fan. Like, people are just, they have a good time.
They show up, they
fucking, you know,
they spend,
you know,
money at the bar, they show up, they let it loose, they have a good time.
They get
yeah.
fucked up, they
the
fuck
thing is that
up.
Our
they
fans,
have
a, that, like, a huge thing with us is that.
Thanks.
If you.
That's true.
I was actually going to say to you, I was say to you before, man, that's awesome that you're fucking straight edge, man. Not that
I
am.
No, I'm straight edge.
Either way, man,
it, I'm really not.
Good
but,
shit.
Yeah,
man.
I'm
like, yeah,
I'm not drinking tonight.
Yeah, me neither.
You know,
I was for my high school career. I got shit for it all the time, but after the jaw pain and my
Are you still?
I broke down and smoked pot because it was either that or kill myself.
No, yeah, you don't like. Tell him about why that is. He doesn't know anything about that. If
well,
you don't mind.
I mean, I was always anti-drugs. I like no sex, no alcohol, no nothing. And then I think I was like 20.
Wait, no sex? Is that what happened?
Is that what happened?
Like,
Stonz knows all about that.
No,
not
I don't.
Sure.
That's the problem.
I was like 20-something. The line, like, fucked my job completely. I mean, it felt like a drill in my head.
They don't know you have Lyme. Like, they don't know how that, when that started or anything.
Well, I've had Lyme for probably about 15 years.
Yeah, he has Lyme too.
Yeah, he has Lyme. Wow.
Oh. It's diagnosed from 99 to about 2008.
Yeah.
The first misdiagnosis, they were going to amputate my leg. Well, from the knee down. And yeah, just it took so long that my body's so saturated with it that it's like, I mean, I can only use some of my fingers now. It's fucked up every part of my body. It's in my brain, my heart, every organ almost.
Do you take any medication for it?
Yeah, I take 500,000 milligram shot of penicillin a week and 4,000, I think it's 4,000 milligrams of clarithromycin a day.
She's you if you weren't if you were misdiagnosed.
Yeah.
Yeah, I wasn't misdiagnosed. I was like diagnosed when I was like a baby. I got it.
Wow.
It affects me, but nowhere as near as much as it does you. You know, like if it rains, my bones get like, you know, really crampy.
It feels like they're on fire.
Yeah, and like I have a horrible memory. I have like a really bad memory from
it. That's true.
Like definitely when I'm on the brain pills, because it's at the point where it's like Alzheimer's type of bad. So that's what
my
now.
Like my whole, all the men in our family have it. My, both my brothers, my father, my grandfather. We all
wait, it gets transferred from generation to generation.
It can be sexually. I know.
Oh no shit!
Wow.
They have sex
with
each other.
Oh, sorry, maybe. Yeah.
I didn't know that.
I didn't know that.
I didn't either.
Shit.
If you're a female, you have about a 1 in 100 chance of passing it to a male. If you're a male, you have a smaller chance of passing it to a female. Because females have natural antibacterial properties in their JJs.
In their hoo-hoos.
They get,
and
like,
you,
automatic
and
wins.
You can pass it to a child. So, I mean, even if I was well enough to take care of a kid, I'd never, ever fucking take that chance. I couldn't imagine a baby having what I have. I wouldn't fucking live with myself.
It sucks. I've heard of, like, people's, like, faces, like, going half-face and shit.
Well,
you know, like, doing that whole
face
thing. I don't know.
Warned me that would probably happen to me at some point.
It lasts
about 2 weeks at a time.
Really?
I want to know your guys' opinion on something then. You said that you wouldn't pass it on to kids, and I understand and I respect your position on that. But just out of curiosity, my mom, she was an insulin-dependent diabetic. Now diabetes skips a generation. So when you have kids or whatever, you know that your grandkids are going to have diabetes. And some of them, she would go to support groups, and some of the people at the support groups, because the fact that she had kids, would look at her like, why would you continue to perpetuate this problem? Do you guys feel the same way about diabetes that you do about Lyme's disease, as far as passing it on to
if they diagnose it, like, you know, if they can diagnose it at an early age, it's not an issue, I don't think. I mean, not that much, you know, because I was diagnosed so young that
with the Lyme's, right?
Yeah,
right.
It wasn't.
So you would procreate and you'd have children, you know, even knowing that you have, you know, Lyme's, and there's a chance that it could be passed on to another generation.
Oh, that's an interesting question.
I mean, yeah, no, true. I hear you, and I understand why you wouldn't necessarily want to.
No, I'm just asking, dude. You don't have to answer. You can say, dude, you're a dick. I don't know.
As long as you don't judge him by his answer.
No, not at all.
I mean,
to be honest with you, with me, it wouldn't be an issue. I don't think it would be. I think that, you know, that if they had it and it was diagnosed, it could be saved. But, I mean, I don't know. To be honest with you, I don't want kids.
Well, kids, that's all.
Go ahead. But it's more of a personal decision rather than the Lyme.
There's also a huge difference between...
Yeah. Yeah, what I have and what she has.
Yeah, right.
Exactly, yeah. So yeah, if it was like, you know...
Controlled versus not controlled, you're looking at two different, very different
things.
That's
what I was saying, you know.
Oh, well, no, well, the aspect of motherhood would be one thing on Sarah's end, and I respect that, you know, like, hey, am I going to be able to raise this child? But the question of just the fact that, okay, you're at a certain stage or whatever, would you have a child knowing that they would have the potential to have Lyme disease?
I've had insulin-dependent diabetes since I was 11. So
really? So you're
familiar with having both diseases.
You're an insulin-dependent diabetic on top of the Lyme's?
Dude, I just took an insulin shot in front of you guys, like 10...
Wow, look at that orange tip. I remember them.
Giggity. So I am intimately aware of both of these problems.
Possibly.
And I can tell you that when I was first diagnosed, you know, you this hear so much shit like, oh, you could lose a foot, you could fuck, all this shit can happen.
Yeah, gangrene's a bitch. Dialysis is a bitch.
Probably have the most well-controlled blood sugars of most of the patients my doctor sees.
Oh, good for you.
I don't consider it, and it's more of a problem to people who are irresponsible most of the time. And I don't think that to be offensive.
Mom was very responsible, as a matter of fact. She really rarely had any, you know, I mean, I watched in their support group, a lot of her friends have reactions a lot. And Mom was pretty responsible. And, you know, Mom outlived a lot of them, but she was in the same way, where she was so insulin-dependent, diabetic. It was a miracle she was never on dialysis or anything, but she died at 59. You know, she was young when she passed away, and she had health issues because of the diabetes. There's no question about it. But she was very responsible.
It does cause a lot of issues. I mean, no matter how healthy, it's almost
the other insulin-dependent diabetic.
How much can you slow down the process of decay?
Okay.
You know, I was always worried, like, oh, one day diabetes is going to just fuck up my body completely. And after I got Lyme, I don't even think about diabetes. Like, diabetes is joke to me. To myself.
So you wouldn't,
diabetes.
You would have kids still with the diabetes. You wouldn't give a shit about what people say.
Absolutely.
But with the Lyme's, is it because of your condition that you're in with the Lyme's? Or is it because of... you know, what you would fear your kids would have to go through because of the Lyme, the reason why you wouldn't have kids. Which one is it?
Well, I can't personally take care of a child, but besides that, I would never have a child no matter how much better I got, because I would never
want them to experience your Lyme. Yeah. So it comes down to an experience thing. What you're both saying is that your own personal experiences are dictating
thank you, sir.
The idea of if you would have kids or not based on your own personal experience.
Don't most decisions you make in your life are based on personal experience?
Yeah, but with a disease, your personal experience,
it could very easily vary.
You would have to look at a bigger box.
Yeah, but the other thing about
which I'm not saying you guys haven't necessarily done, but maybe you could pass that mentality.
But the other point to make here is that when you know you have something, it's very different than not knowing you have it for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
It's possible to live a normal, healthy, fun, happy life with something, knowing what's happening from the get-go, rather than fucking being dropped into it after a decade of misdiagnosis. You know what I mean? So, like...
Yeah. Oh, right, right. Well, yeah. Well, with that, you
right?
know...
Exactly. You know, yeah. Like I said, you know, mine was straight cut. I haven't, you know... They didn't
right.
know
if you had a kid, you know, they would test him, and then they know the tests are wrong a lot of the time, so they would continue to test.
You're only about 60% accurate, and that's the other problem. It's very easy to test for diabetes. Get on the medicine immediately. See the symptoms; they're very cut and dry. The problem with Lyme is you can take 50 Lyme tests and have false negatives.
Wow.
They're only about 60% accurate.
There are a lot of them that are like that too. I mean, like, even you could have AIDS for like 2 to 3 years before it'll even show up on a test. You know what
but
I mean?
But
like,
your responsibility.
So, I mean, a lot of people, like, you have a promiscuous night or you're out doing all kinds of shit you're not sure about. You go get tested and then, like, you get a negative. And you're just like, oh, all right, fuck it, I'm never doing that again. You know what I mean? Like,
you're talking, surprise, two years later,
you know, like you're fucked.
But you're talking to a guy that me specifically. You're talking to a guy, me.
Are you sure you're a
that,
guy?
That firsthand witnessed being able to be responsible with insulin dependent diabetes, and I still feel as though it affected. You know, even though you can be diagnosed with insulin dependent diabetes. The potential is there to it drastically affecting your life. You know, there's different levels of diabetes. You know, insulin dependent diabetes.
There is. I mean, just because one is well
levels.
Controlled doesn't
right.
mean someone else's can be well controlled.
Right.
I completely
Absolutely.
Agree.
Absolutely.
I guess I just see. Let's put it this way: if Lyme isn't caught, or if you catch it at the stage I caught it, or any time around that. You're not looking at, let me take my medicine to get better.
Right,
you're
not looking at
that.
Right.
You have been given a slow death. I will die from Lyme disease. It will kill me. I will not be able to fight it off forever. It will fucking kill me. I don't believe that diabetes will kill me. And that is somewhat personal experience making the call, but also I've seen when I look on Facebook on the Lyme pages, dude, I see about 2 or 3 people die a week from those fucking communities I look at, and it kills me because it could have been avoided completely. There's accurate testing and accurate treatment for diabetes coming out constantly.
I drove an ambulance for 10 years for private service. I watched a lot of people pass away in horrible ways because of insulin dependent diabetes. So you know, I don't see a lot of difference with
nothing. I'm not saying that doesn't happen. I think the medical establishment has a hold on diabetes. It's known to chronic Lyme disease isn't even acknowledged as a real disease. According to the medical community, what I have doesn't exist.
Do you think that's a fabric? Do you think that there's an agenda behind that? By the way, do you think that there is?
No, but I mean, fuck the agenda on top of it. Like, I think the most awful thing about that is the fact that you can see. I mean, it's plain to see. Like, if you hang out with Sarah ever, it's plain to see the effect it's having on her life and how you could walk into a doctor's office like that and have some guy stare at you and say, it's all in your head. It's all in your head. It's not real. It doesn't really exist.
Because I can even see
it's all in your head. It's not real.
Don't mean to be offensive, but Sarah, I've seen pictures of you, and sometimes, yeah, as an ambulance, maybe most of the people wouldn't pick it up, but I pick up some things in some of those photos, and I see, you know, for any doctor to tell you that it's all in your fucking head.
Well, it's just
to see,
like, you know,
to see, like, your skin tone and things like that, like, you know. It's
Stonz.
No. There's another one.
Stonz to the K.
Yeah. That's fucked up.
I let him.
Fucked up.
Continue your thing.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, what was it? When we first met, they were still trying to tell you the same thing, right? I think around the time we first met, you were getting to the point where you needed help. Like, you know, getting upstairs and walking and stuff like that, and it was getting really bad.
We might have just met around the time that it was becoming very visible that I had something wrong. In fact, I had met you
a couple of times and you were okay, you were still mobile, it was all right. And then, like, when we actually really started hanging out and going to shows and stuff, and the cane showed up and you really had trouble, stairs were, like, impossible. And stuff like that, and you were telling me right at that time that, I went to the doctor today, they're still telling me it's all in my head. It's a figment of my imagination, I'm creating this.
Yeah, I think I met you guys after
fucking lunacy. It's criminal.
So do you think that
the first misdiagnosis that almost led to an amputation was not one doctor. That was a team of seven doctors, four infectious disease
doctors. Well, no, but it's a voting thing. Once you get seven doctors, once you get them in the same room, they vote or whatever. Back to my question. Do you think that Lyme's disease, that there's a political agenda behind Lyme's disease?
It's not even an opinion. It is an absolute fact. And
This is what needs to be said.
Good for you.
Let me tell you how it works. When you walk into a doctor's office with a disease, they have a series of treatment guidelines that they are supposed to follow that are given to them by an insurance company. Now, if you walk into a place and they have treatment guidelines for Lyme, those guidelines say you get a bullseye rash 100% of the time or you don't have Lyme, which most people don't see the rash because they can only have it for an hour sometimes or get it on under their hair. Some people don't get it at all. Secondly, they say that it cannot be a clinical diagnosis anymore, which eradicates most people with Lyme because now they have to rely on a test that's only 60% accurate.
Are there other tests that are actually like that you could visually see right away? Is there other stuff out there?
There was one that was not FDA approved, which means an insurance company won't accept those results.
Jesus Christ. Sounds pretty political.
The other thing they say, and this is the one that's been absolutely killing people, literally killing people, is that a month of treatment on doxycycline will cure Lyme disease, and if you still have sickness after that month, you don't have Lyme disease, and should be recommended to a psychiatrist.
What's the percentage of successes with the doxycycline and this other test? Out of curiosity, too. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be kicking over.
It's all right, go ahead, dude. This is a good conversation.
But I do have to get Jacque on the phone.
Yeah,
that's
true.
That's like 20 minutes late.
Give it a couple more. Go ahead.
But this is good.
What's the success rate? What's the success rate on the doxycycline?
If it's caught early, it's extremely successful.
Okay, so it's caught early. And this other test that they have available, what's the success rate of that test? The other one that the FDA doesn't approve for the insurance company?
That test was something like 90-something percent accuracy.
Wow. So the question becomes, why do they...
Because it costs
good
so
question.
Much money.
It's too expensive.
She just said it.
Expensive.
Hang on.
Really?
Say it again.
She's cutting out.
Company trying to get FDA approval, you need millions of dollars to do that. So most companies that come up with great ideas will not get that approval, will not get the insurance companies to give it shit. And this is the biggest problem. The people that wrote those guidelines, I think something like 9 out of 13 of them work for insurance companies.
So
for people that were patenting Lyme disease products.
So the insurance companies just don't give a shit.
Please. My wife.
They give a shit.
Hold up. Time out.
There's no point
in
doing it.
No, that's the thing. There's no fucking money in a cure. That you absolutely have to remember
money
that at all points in time. Treatment makes money. There is no money in a cure. You know what I mean?
Ready to go?
And my wife works for a neurosurgeon, a neurophysiology office. And she handles billing, and she is the one, when you come with your insurance cards, you give them to the front desk, and your insurance company dicks out and says, we don't cover that. My wife is the one who goes to bat for you and says, no, you're gonna fucking pay for this, okay? And, like, the shit that she has told me, dude, they don't care. They don't care. They don't fucking care, dude.
It's the same thing.
They don't care at all.
Let me just by telling you the end result of what has been happening because of this shit. Because of this, Lyme doctors that go against the guidelines and say, you're still sick, I need to give you long-term antibiotic treatment, are getting calls to medical boards from the insurance companies and having their licenses taken away. Aww. What this means is if you go into most doctor's offices, they will be scared to treat you for Lyme and tell you it is something else. That's and that has happened
so
many times.
The doctor's fucking
and
bad.
There are so many doctors that were treat. In fact, the only doctor in this country that treats pediatric cases of Lyme is now in a like 6-year court battle to have his license taken away and has no money. He's an 80-year-old man. He's treated people with Lyme from every fucking country and province in Canada. And if he gets taken away and your kid gets sick, where is he gonna go? That's why it is absolutely political. There's no doubt about it.
I wanna come back to this. I have to get Jacque on the phone. She's calling from Louisiana, so
Louisiana.
I'm gonna let her know to call in. All I gotta do is connect her to the Bluetooth.
Yup.
What is this thing?
That is the Bluetooth speaker. Hooray for technology. And that.
Jesus Christ. While we're waiting for her, does anybody have anything else to say on this subject?
Yes, I absolutely do. I have a history with my airway and health that is so long I won't even get into now. But a lot of bullshit that I've gone through is probably similar to some of the problems that Sarah's experienced. There's a massive amount of doctors, especially residents, and now these days with the insurance being shit, we have more and more residency practices. All the insurance companies.
Call from 225-229.
Can we come back?
Yes. Pause. Remind me there, Sarah.
Hmm? Hello?
Remind me where we left off.
Jacque, are you there?
Hello?
Hey!
Hi, Jacque. Hey, Jacque!
Jacque Brown.
Jacque, everyone's here. We're all
listening. Hello?
Do you hear me? Andrew, fix it.
Jacque, hello? Can you hear us?
Hello?
Hey, can you hear me?
I can hear you now.
Yeah.
Okay, hold on. We're going to try to put you on Bluetooth.
Put our phone right on the speaker.
No, no, no.
Oh, Joe, the speaker's not fucking working.
Okay, so we're getting ready to, hold on.
Put the phone up close to the mic.
Okay, I got it. Sorry, we're having all kinds of technological problems tonight.
Fuck technology!
But we love it. How are you, Jacque?
I'm doing good. How are you, Ricky?
All right. At what time is it where you are?
It is 9:44.
Okay, I apologize for calling you late.
It's okay.
Okay. So there's a lot of us here tonight. We're having a lot of fucked up problems with the feed to Justin TV tonight. We know that. We're going to fix it in the coming weeks. However, this is going to be on YouTube tomorrow. It's going to be crystal clear. It's going to be beautiful. So you wrote a poem. I want you to tell everybody, first of all, I want you to tell everybody about yourself, what the poem is called, and why this poem is important to you.
Okay. The poem is called, well, let me start with myself. I am a poet. I just finished my MFA at Solstice, which is where I met Rick.
Mm-hmm.
I've been a poet, what I feel like has been my entire life, but I just got credentials that says I'm a poet.
Okay.
And the poem I wrote is called Regarding Trayvon Martin.
Okay.
And it came in response to, I guess, my personal frustration at another disrespect for black bodies.
Okay.
Particularly male bodies.
Sure.
So it was my response to how I was feeling, my frustration, my sadness, my own personal feelings with regard to that.
Okay.
So.
Why, I'm trying to ask questions that I feel like are, maybe, important, whether they be difficult or not.
sure.
I feel like a lot of people are find it important to just continue to move on from issue to issue, and from one incident to the next. Why do you feel it's important to keep this issue alive, and how do you feel about the, I guess I want to say, the climate in this country that keeps this kind of thing alive?
Well, a lot of people have have the luxury to keep moving past this sort of thing. Unfortunately, I don't have that luxury. I am a woman of color. I am married to a man of color. I have a son who is of color, obviously.
How old is your son?
My son's 21.
Okay.
Well, he'll be 21 in September. And so it's always an issue and a fear bubbling under the surface for women who are the parents, the mothers of black boys.
Mm-hmm.
And it just brings me to, it makes me think about a situation where we were at workshop this past residency, and we were workshopping a poem that I had brought to workshop once before. And what started as a simple haiku poem with regard to my son, and basically it was addressing him coming home from work. He had worked a late shift,
sure,
which was what the poem was called. He had come home from a late shift, and I was waiting up, as I always do, when, you know, I know he's going to come home late.
Sure.
And the question came up in class, why is this poem relevant? Why is this poem important? Because it's a feeling that all mothers have with regard to their children, with regard to, you know, being concerned about them, particularly when they're out late. And I didn't have an answer immediately, because I identified with that, and that made perfect sense. You know, that is a common feeling. But, you know, as I went back to rewrite the poem and consider the comments that had been made, you know, and kind of like scratch beyond the surface of the initial impetus for the poem, what I realized is that it's not just a mother's concern for a child, it's a black mother's concern for a boy,
sure,
a black boy whose life isn't valued. It's her concern that, you know, he could be anywhere at any time, driving black,
sure,
walking in the wrong neighborhood black,
right,
in a convenience store black. There's always, you know, the potential for something to go wrong by virtue of his skin. And so that's a fear that all mothers do not have.
Okay. Hold on. My buddy Stonz, who's on the show, wants to ask you a question.
I think we can all respect all of your viewpoints on this matter. I just have two simple questions for you. Number one, do you think that there's a solution in the future? If you do, what is that? And the second question I have is, do you think that progress has been made and that we're heading in the right direction? Is that a possibility for you in your position? Do you think that do you feel that that's a reality or not?
I don't personally feel that that's a reality that I will enjoy in my lifetime. That's a sad admission, but I feel that it's an accurate one, at least in my position. I feel like for as far as we've come and for as much as we've seen happen in our lifetime and for as many advances as we've made as people of color, certain things have remained constant.
I can respect that, sure. I can respect that answer.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so, I mean, I would love to enjoy an opportunity to live in a world where I don't have to be concerned about what people think about the color of my skin or how I'm treated because of the color of my skin, or where I don't have to have that additional fear tacked on to my psyche as a mother bearing children of color, particularly boys. That would be a world I would love to come back and see.
Okay, what needs to happen to get humanity there, in your opinion? Just if you think it's a possibility, or, and if you do, you know, if you do have any hints as to what you feel as though, you know, the reality, you know, how do we get there? Because I think we all want to get there. I definitely do think everybody wants to be there.
Well, I think a lot of people want to be there. Unfortunately, I don't think we all want to be there. I think that it starts by conversation.
Sure.
I think it starts by us not having a fear of each other to where we feel like we can't have a conversation with one another without some sort of backlash.
Sure.
I think that, you know, opportunities present themselves. And I think that, you know, if we're so fearful of a conversation with each other that we can't ever get there, if we can't, you know, sit around the table and have an honest discussion, like, for instance, like I said, I just graduated from Solstice, and one of the issues that I, as a person of color, dealt with directly was something as simple as the texture of my hair. I was in an environment where, because I was the other, the texture of my hair became
a thing. It became a self-consciousness. That's
right.
That's really that's
became
that's
a
incredible.
Thing. It was a thing, you know. And you know, I personally, it doesn't bother me so much to where I'm not willing to have a conversation, because I feel like that's the starting place for us to get past.
But you're wondering in yourself, like, what are these other people, you know, are they judging me on something as simple as, you know, the texture of my hair? And that's got to be incredible, a pretty incredible way to live. I honestly, I personally. I mean, I could relate to you in a sense that, like, you know, I mean, I personally have a disability where my eye is deformed or whatever, and I could see, like, you know, I question, you know, what other people going to think of me, but I don't think I could personalize it to your level. That's really impressive to try and to understand and respect that viewpoint.
Jacque, I remember having this conversation in Massachusetts, and we were sitting in a bar, we were laughing. I remember talking about, you said this story about how you were in a supermarket and these white people came up to you and asked you if they could touch your hair.
Yeah, wow. That happens all the time.
And I remember saying, I'm so sorry for white people. We don't get out much.
You know what, though? Allow me to play devil's advocate. I have to...
This is Ryan talking.
I'm sorry, yeah. Hi, Jacque. It's Ryan. Forgive me for playing devil's advocate, but you know what? I have to applaud that those white people actually walked up and said, hey, can I touch your hair?
Yeah.
Because I know a lot of hate-filled motherfuckers who would have just walked to the other side of the room and stayed and said, you know, like...
Yeah, sure.
And really
hold
let
on,
it
I want
show.
Her answer to that. What do you think to that?
What?
What he said about how
you think that's progress?
I didn't say that. I didn't say it's progress. I'm just saying, like, I actually have to go, that's kind of a funny story, you know what I mean? And I think that at least they said something. At least they came up and asked a question, say, can we touch your hair?
Right.
So, I mean, like, it's as
right.
inappropriate
let's
as talk. It is.
Yeah.
And the funny part, because, you know, I've had this conversation with other students at Tulsa who have had similar instances happen to them. And we laugh about it because this happens to us all the time. And what seems like a ridiculous thing, which, as I've said before, I don't have a problem if you ask me. You know, if there's a way that you go about entering into that conversation, you know, what I have a problem with is privilege. And people thinking that they're entitled to touch my hair.
I'm sorry, what did you say? What was the last thing you said?
I'm
sorry, the last thing you said about your hair?
My problem is with privilege and with people who feel like they're entitled to touch my hair and entitled to approach me in ways that are inappropriate. That's what I have a problem with. But if I've entered into a situation where I'm having a conversation with, say, for instance, Rick, because we've had conversations like this before, you know, and you ask me a question and, you know, we're engaged in this dialogue, and one of the things that you want to do is touch my hair, I'm okay with that.
Sure.
If you've asked my permission. And if I don't feel like you're putting me in a position of, you know, I don't know what a word for that would be. But, you know,
back against the wall kind of thing where you're cornered.
Right.
Sure.
You're
putting me in a position to where I feel like, you know, you're invading my space or whatever.
How are you supposed to respond to a question? If I had a random stranger come up, regardless of color, and they were just like, "Can I feel your hair?" It's kind of a unique situation, at least from my perspective. It would be like,
that's because nobody wants to touch your hair.
God, not even want to touch my hair.
Regardless, it's unique when it happens once, sure. But it's not unique when it happens on a regular basis. Like, this is something that happens to me on a pretty regular basis.
Wow.
So just let you know a little bit of personal information about myself. I live in a poor black neighborhood, actually, believe it or not. I'm a white guy, you know, I live in a poor black neighborhood. I came up in middle class white America, all right? Maybe even semi upper middle class, like my father, he came from funeral home money, but he didn't have it, you know, so it was like lower / upper middle class. Middle class white family. That's where I grew up, and I currently now live in a low income black neighborhood. All right.
Mm-hmm.
Now my kids, I have two kids, age 7 and 11, and they go outside and they play. And when they encounter, you know, other people in the neighborhood, you know, I always enforce with them that, you know, there is no issue of color or anything like that. But on occasion they'll encounter a force in the neighborhood of somebody of color that will try and dominate the neighborhood. And I try to reinforce with them that, you know, listen, you know, there's no issue with color. I you know, he has a friend, you know, he's quite a few, you know, Hispanic and people of color friends. But what, you know, one of his friends in particular is of color, and like, he donated his bicycle when he was 7 years old to another family for Christmas because they didn't have a bike. Like, he gave up his bike, so I would loan him my kid's bike all the time because, like, he straight out was like, you know, I gave these kid, you know, this other family my bicycle or whatever. And I think that that's a really good family and a really good example. So my question to you is do you think that there has been progression along those lines? Or do you think that there's still, you know, this really long road ahead of us where we have to, you know, do a lot more work than not? Because as a third generation removed, I think that I am being progressive with my kids. And I would hope that other people that have lived a similar lifestyle that I have would also say that, you know, there's a lot of progression there. And that, you know, it's flat out, I don't care if the kid's white or black or gray or green, if you're a dick, you're a dick. I don't want my kids hanging around dicks, but anybody that's cool, you know, yeah, go over their house, learn from them, that, you know, diversity is key. And do you think that's a sign of progression, or do you think that was even a possibility 40 years
ago? Well,
I think,
you know, if you're raising your children, Let's address the issue of the bike. Okay, if you know, it doesn't matter if it's a person of color or if they're red, green, or yellow.
My point was there is that I think that kid was really cool to do that. Like, I was impressed
Oh,
with
absolutely.
That kid's, you know,
absolutely.
Motivation there, sure.
Absolutely, yes. I definitely think that that's a character trait that I would expect that I'm instilling in my own children, that if you see a need that you can meet, to meet it. But that has no bearing on the issue of race. With regard to, you know, meeting that need, it's going to take a whole lot more than offering, you know, a kid who doesn't have a bicycle. Like, it's going to take a conversation, like I said before. Sure. Like it, and it's going to take more than just one kid. You know, looking at someone who he feels he can help by offering his bicycle to change the race situation in the United States.
He's been wanting to ask questions for like 10 minutes. By the way, this is Johnny from the show.
How you doing, Jacque?
Okay.
My name's Johnny.
Hi, Johnny.
I had a bunch of things to say, real short, quick, eloquent. Now I have a lot more to say and a couple of questions, but a couple of the statements I have are contingent upon your responses as well as everyone else's.
Sure.
As far as everything goes with this whole case, the verdict, everything.
Oh, you're talking about Trayvon Martin.
Yeah,
sure.
I get it, everything, but I'm ignorant to all the details.
Okay.
Well, we'll fill you in.
Yeah.
So, I guess... My question, and just keep the answer real short if possible, because, like I said, I have backup questions. Why is it what it sounds like about race? Why does it sound like it was a race issue?
I can't understand
what makes the,
I hear you, but I can understand.
What makes the Trayvon Martin case a race issue? In your opinion.
There are a couple of things.
Okay.
He was pursued, number one, in a neighborhood where his father lived.
Right.
As a suspect. I'm not sure that would happen if he were not a person of color.
Right.
I've not heard very many stories of where there's been a white person who saw someone white that was unfamiliar in a neighborhood being pursued first in a vehicle and then, you know, in hot pursuit. So that would be the first issue. And then secondly, once he made the phone call and let the police know what was going on, that should have been the end of the situation. I don't know. And I've not heard any stories, and that doesn't suggest that it never happened before, but I've not heard any stories where, you know, someone goes in pursuit of someone not of color in that way, particularly after they've been told by the authorities that they're going to take over from there.
Yeah.
So that gives me pause and makes me wonder what was so particularly special about this young man that made that person, being George Zimmerman, want to go in hot pursuit of him when he was simply walking home. Now, if, you know, if the situation would be different, maybe, if he were lurking around someone's house or,
right,
you know, by a window or, you know, on someone's porch where he knew no one of color lived. But even in that scenario, what gives you the right to make that sort of pursuit of someone, particularly after you've been warned not to do that?
Exactly. Even the police are supposedly, they have to have probable cause, and this man was not a policeman. He was a civilian. I mean,
right,
you need beyond probable cause as a civilian, you
right
know?
Regardless.
Right.
I mean, regardless.
And
yeah,
this is
absolutely.
Something,
walking down the street
experience
with a hoodie on at night is not probable cause.
Yeah, and by the way, we're all
absolutely
guilty of that.
Absolutely. You know that and that's something that happens on a regular basis, and not just, you know, in neighborhoods and communities, but in grocery stores and, you know, in stores and you know, that sort of thing. That happens all the time. We hear about it all the time, and it's primarily a person of color where those sorts of things happen.
Sure. Yeah.
So that to me makes it an issue of race.
Sometimes I wonder.
It's unfortunate, but that's the way that it is.
Sometimes I wonder if it's a perception issue.
Let me finish.
Who, like, it depends on who's perceived as a bad person or a who. Like I can remember being young and having piercings and having long hair or a mohawk or anything.
Yeah.
And walking into a convenience store, being followed around, being fucked with by the people that work there because their perception of me to have those things was a negative thing.
Yeah.
I just want Johnny Scarpelli to finish.
A couple of the other things I had to say was...
Yeah, it is a perception. And the other thing is that, you know, when you're inundated by the media and social networks and all of that sort of thing, by images of people of color in those sort of characterizations, then it feeds into that frenzy. And it's a poison.
Sure.
And it poisons people. And it even poisons people who may or may not have had those ideas initially. And think about people who don't come in contact with people of color on a regular basis. And if all they've ever seen on television is a black person robbing somebody or killing somebody or in some sort of gang-related violence or what have you, okay, that feeds into a perception.
Sure.
You know, if you're not having a conversation with somebody of color and you don't know anybody of color who doesn't fit into those stereotypes, that feeds into your lack of information.
Right. Go ahead, Johnny. I'll let Johnny finish.
I just have two quick points, and you guys, I'm sure, will run with this.
Sure.
And please, that's the point of... That's the one I want to say.
No, we're asking difficult questions.
The first thing is, and correct me if I'm wrong afterwards and everything, I don't think that this should be an issue of color or race or anything, unless... I don't know about anything that happened.
Sure, sure.
But unless... The guy said, I followed him and pursued him and went after him because he was black.
Right.
No one should be talking about race.
You're talking about assumptions.
Well, that doesn't. Yes. Yeah, but that's, I mean, what racist ever comes out and says, true, oh, I did that because of the color of his skin?
Racist ones.
Yeah, some of the more bold ones, but not the ones who are facing murder charges.
But I do see his point. It's more of a suspect issue.
But where does that inherent suspect issue come from is the question.
Yeah. Right. And that's our perception.
And that's, that's kind of where I wanted to go.
And it all ties into where I was going to agree with you, Jacque. Like, nothing is going to change unless everyone just stops.
Right, and we have a conversation.
Unless what?
But we're making it.
He said, nothing is ever going to change unless everybody just stops. Like, alluding to what you were saying before is positive, forward-moving conversation where we are all able to just let things go and just start talking and let the fear go and let the enlightenment come in.
Let him finish.
You know, like, I'm agreeing with you, but I'm also, you know, with all due respect, I'm also telling you that part of your approach to this is part of the problem, because the more we talk about things need to change instead of just changing them, we're not going
to
get anywhere.
Well, I think putting the message out
there... You're absolutely right.
Yeah, she just said you're right.
But you have to take those steps. And this is the bigger part of the problem.
You're right about that.
And those steps aren't being taken. And I don't know, personally, I can only be in charge of myself. I can only be in charge of what Jacquelyn does and what Jacquelyn puts into the universe, okay?
You can only be in charge of your experience.
I can invite people into my sphere.
Sure.
And I can have these conversations with people that I invite, but it doesn't always go in the other direction.
Yeah. And I will say this.
Like it doesn't often go in the other direction, and that's the unfortunate part about it.
Right.
You know, there are opportunities for people to have that back and forth conversation, but it's not happening.
Right. And I will say this. I will say this for just to put it out there. Jackie's had this conversation with me, and she called in and is very eloquently having this conversation.
Oh, she's doing
it.
This is what needs to happen.
And I think you guys are on the same level with that.
Yeah, because
that conversation, these conversations need to happen.
Nothing is going to change. Nothing's going to change if people keep like snickering.
And that's what I was alluding to. Here's kind of the like. Just I guess this all kind of works well into I don't want to like go too long with it, but like Stonz had said before, you know what I mean? I'm a father. I'm a Caucasian. I'm a father. I live in a trailer park in New Jersey, low income housing. Actually, it was privately owned when I moved in, so you had to pay your bills. You know, you had to either put a down payment or buy your trailer outright. And it's since been taken over by the government. It's been graded for Section 8, everything like that. You know, they're moving in Hurricane Sandy victims, all kinds of people and stuff like that. And but even when it was privately owned, when I was there, it is a melting pot. It's an absolute melting pot between, you know, there's a lot of white people, a lot of black people, a lot of Hispanic people. Just people all over the place, and we the thing that I notice inside there, and I mean, like, you have your troublemakers, you know what I mean, and they're all shapes and sizes, all different colors, you know, and a lot of them happen to live on one specific street, and we all know what's going on over there, and it has nothing to do with what color you are or who you are. It's just the simple fact that, you know, we know that the people scoring fucking heroin and crack and who are getting into all kinds of trouble are on this one street, and then there are three other blocks of us away from there who get along great. You know, our kids play together. And I remember, like, when the hurricane happened and nobody had power, the Ortiz family had a generator. My family still had propane flowing to the kitchen so we could cook food. And then there was a lady up the street who still had a working vehicle and everything like that, hadn't been crushed by a tree, you know what I mean? Like, it's, so she was giving rides, I was cooking for people's kids, and you could go down the street to the other family's house and you could use your cell phone and everything, and we all kind of banded together, and we've just
and
been
this,
like that,
is
you know?
Is this Ryan talking?
Yeah, it's Ryan. And we've all you know, it's been like that, even like, you know, and it was nice, really, really nice to know, especially when the shit hit the fan like that and there was no cops coming in, nothing happening, you know, we all just kind of formed the little circle and circled the wagons and took care of each other and everything was okay. And it's just kind of like things like that make me think about how much.
But it shouldn't take a natural disaster.
Yeah. Oh, but I mean, it's not like that. Just a natural. Like, we're all really cool with each other. You know what I mean? Like, we're even on the sunniest day of the year, we're all barbecuing and we're all hanging out and having fun together. Which kind of like, that's why when I see, and I'm with you. I believe this whole thing is definitely a little bit racially charged. I don't think the guy had any right to go anywhere near that kid, especially since. He called the cops. He called 911. He enlisted the police, and then
he
went outside of their order and everything. And that's, you know, when I see people on the street, when I see people in local communities and stuff like that, I don't encounter it too much. But it's when I turn on the TV and when I see public relations and mass media and stuff like that, that's when the race point is really driven home for a lot of people. Do you really think,
absolutely,
like? Do you think that it's an inherent thing within our society, or do you think we're kind of being force-fed, you know, racist ideas and racist bullshit? I don't think most of us actually believe it.
Go ahead, Jacque.
Yeah, you're absolutely being force-fed. And then, you know, like we've already discussed, it's a perception. So in order to change the perception, you have to do something.
Sure.
You have to deny what you're being. So this is my thing. If we're in a car together, if Rick and I are in a car together,
mm-hmm.
and we're pulled over. And we're pulled over under suspicion of some illegal activity. Okay? And I shouldn't pick Rick. Maybe I should pick Ryan, which I don't even know what Ryan looks like, but I know what Rick looks like.
He's 6 foot six, white
Rick,
and blue eyes.
Rick, you're going to jail with me because you have the look that they want. You have the look that perceives that you got some, heroin, some stuff. You know, but if I'm in a vehicle with some, straight laced Caucasian male, and we're pulled over because there's an issue that they think that some illegal activity is going on, I'm going to be the one that gets harassed.
Yeah.
You know, because that's the perception. I'm the guilty one. You know, I'm the one who, is the troublemaker. I'm the one that's going to have to answer all the questions and be pursued and be, held up in whatever the situation may be. Before, this other person is in the same vehicle, going in the same, we're in the same car doing the same thing, whatever. But I'm going to be the most likely suspect just by virtue of the color of my skin. That's the thing that has to change.
Agreed.
That's the idea that
Jacque,
has to change.
Jacque, I don't think there's a single person here that wouldn't agree. What? You are a great guest. You are eloquent. You answer questions absolutely beautifully. You're willing to tackle a difficult fucking shit with us, and I appreciate that. However, we do need to bring this conversation to a close. We got to air your poem.
Okay.
You got to come back, though, Jacque, because I got some questions for you.
She will. Hold on.
This is a great conversation.
I want you to just say what the name of your poem is, why you wrote it, and what you hope for. Just talk about it just a little bit, and then we're gonna have to cut you off.
That's perfectly fine.
Mm-hmm.
The poem is called "Regarding Trayvon Martin," and what I hope is accomplished by listeners to the poem or readers of the poem is that they think about the person before the flesh. I hope that the person is given a chance before the perception, at all times, no matter what the situation, the person before the perception.
Well put.
We agree. Everyone agrees.
Very, very well put. That's a very, very insightful turn of phrase for this particular situation, and I think we couldn't agree more.
Absolutely. Jacque, thank you so much for calling in. Thank you for this. This has been great.
Thank you, Jacque.
We will have you on again. We will have you on again. We're going to air your poem.
We're definitely doing the poem. We're airing it.
We're airing your poem right now. Hopefully everything's up on YouTube tomorrow. Thank you for everything. When we come back from the poem, we're going to be talking to Negative Traction a little more. We're going to end their video.
And we're going to have some Negative Traction video.
That's right.
I can't wait to see this thing.
And thank you very much, Jacque Brown.
You're welcome. Y'all have a great time.
You too.
You too. Thank you, Jacque.
Good night.
I am the mouthpiece of countries, mourning a murdered child, scarlet like blood and sticky on their hands. I am the fear that becomes his face. Wherever I bear witness to his memory and others like him, histories held up by my own son's neck. I am a witness, like sky, the seeing center of a violent storm. I am Trayvon, American and born beneath a broken symbol hanging and cracking in the brisk winds.
That was pretty sweet.
That was pretty good.
Are we on? We are back on. All right, hey, we want to thank Jacque Brown for being on. All the way from New Orleans, Louisiana, taking the time of day to sit and chit-chat with a bunch of retards sitting around a bar. And it was great conversation.
It was.
But now, we are back with Negative Traction.
We're back with Negative Traction.
And we're going to get back to the fucking funny, goofy shit. So.
And we're artistic. Point about all of this, even though the art was there in the last segment too. The art is
absolutely
whatever it is.
Absolutely.
So, do you guys have shows coming up anytime soon?
Yeah, we do. We actually talked about them before. We have a free show this Friday.
I have a question and I want to ask this one, and
it's Friday.
I think it's the most fun question, like being in a band, that I've ever been asked, is how would you describe your show? Like, serious, like, that's, I mean, full on, like, how would you describe your show, you know?
I'm in the back. So everything that happens, like, there's so many fights that happen at our shows, and it's usually due to all the stupid drunk girls that we have. But it's still hilarious.
Drunk girls?
I've
been starting wars since the beginning of time.
But I'd like to say our shows, we try to make them, like, just a big fucking friend party.
Shit show.
No, I think
rock
that's
and roll.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I hate that over professionalism. I hate that mosh pit mentality that people have now. Like, when somebody falls down, kick them in the head.
We built this band around our friends.
Yeah, friendship.
If we didn't have our fucking friends, we'd have nobody now.
It's
because we had, like, these two fucking loyal people. Then we had Matt come in, and Matt did a lot of fucking
Maddie
shit.
Maddie is a mover. Maddie has
so
the gift of gab.
Like, just put that shit down and go enjoy. He's like, oh, I gotta pick your shit up. I was like, dude, stop.
But it's guys like Matt and like Janine,
it's guys
you know,
like
people
Matt,
like that who really, like, that's a band's best friend, is somebody who believes and somebody who really, really appreciates
exactly
what it is that you're trying to do.
And in return, we give the same respect to every single person. If someone buys a ticket to our show, it's not just we're talking to them because they come to our shows. We're talking to them because we find them interesting. We like them as friends. We hang out with them. Like, anybody that comes to any of our shows, if I had the money, I would buy all their tickets. I would buy all their shots. Whatever they want.
The truth is if you like our band, then you like us as individuals.
Do well than a lot of bands try to do and just fucking can't do. You guys command attention properly. Okay.
Really good.
If there's anything that T.W.I.N.E. is good at, it's getting the people in the back to the front.
Yeah. Yeah.
And the only reason I reference T.W.I.N.E. is because it's the only real reference I have when it comes to understanding.
I mean, we've done it for so long, it's really all, you know.
So you guys know.
Yeah, it's all
right
now.
So, like, to watch you guys able to do the same thing, the only thing I ever want to say to you
is, we know how hard it is. It's impressive.
Do it smart.
Oh, no, absolutely.
You know, like, don't ever hesitate to learn every fucking thing you can, because this is hands down the most corrupt fucking business good people could ever become a part of.
You guys, like what you guys said before, dude, like seriously, and we've seen it go sour for a lot of people a lot of times, but that is like another thing that we, and we still to this, you know, to this day, preach, practice, and live by. Is that, you know, we're not better than anybody. We're just the happen to be the guys on stage. We know what we're doing.
Yeah.
We have a formula. We have an
and
idea.
We
wanted to do something.
Way.
But as far as the show goes, it's bigger than just the band. It's bigger than just the people who've seen
it
at the bar and all that.
So many times we've said it on stage. We're not the band. The people in the crowd are the band.
Yeah.
We're just the guys fucking playing the music. We can come up on stage and sing our song.
It takes a lot of things. It takes a lot of things for a successful show to come off. And I think all of like my favorite, like we had the privilege to open for a lot of people. And the best ones were the ones who were sitting there with you at the bar watching your band set, everybody set, chilling.
Right.
And we've had to play with a couple of other bands who you wouldn't see come off their fucking bus until the show was over. And, you know, people understand that. Fans see that.
They recognize
fans recognize that.
Right.
You know what I mean? When they're sitting there hanging with the guys who took the time, sold the tickets, did all the legwork, and put on a great show, and these guys are hanging with you, and the dudes who are getting paid to be here are sitting on a bus avoiding everybody like the plague. They don't fucking forget that. They remember that shit, you know?
I think the thing with them is like, I've seen them play probably in every type of place. A wrestling hall out in...
we even played a wrestling hall out in...
Wow, that's impressive.
Yeah, that's actually a really funny story.
Impressive.
We can get into it another time, but it was ridiculous. But he's seen us play everywhere. We played at this shitty fucking place
in Philly. Hey, look, you want a loyal fan.
Philly.
It's that guy right
here. Yeah. We're 15 minutes away, and this guy's like, we got a ton of people.
Here's Mike.
Yeah.
But if you ever make him mad, he's going to film a suicide video.
Boy, this is like six people, what was it, like maybe 10 people showed up, 10-15 people came out.
And there was all the people that we drove up,
right?
And
we're
or took their cars.
And you know what? Ball,
hey,
I bet you guys went balls to the wall anyway, right?
Like,
exactly.
Like,
no such thing as a bad show. It's free practice as far as I'm concerned. You know what I mean? Like,
what do you see for the future? In terms of musically, do you guys think about the future, or do you just let it happen? How old are each of you?
This, you guys, I know you can. There was one time, I don't know if you guys noticed, I do like independent hip-hop music. I change my name a bunch of times, so no one knows who I am until I get on stage and talk about myself. I was
we hear the voice, we know, we know who it is. I can hear it with the curtain closed. I'm like,
what's my dick vibrates?
I can feel like the shit that's
tits are rumbling everywhere.
10 points.
I'm at bar.
I'm gonna clink to that. Hang on just a second.
10 points, Stonz.
Beautiful. I'm at bar.
What's your cue number?
I'm watching every single band. The first band gets off, they finish, I go up to them, and for some reason, I'm headlining, whatever. So I go up to the guy, I'm like, hey, bro, that was great. He's like, hey, man, you know what, yeah, great, man, thanks for being a fan. Like, totally disregards me.
Wow.
Tells me, somebody doesn't even know, thanks for being a fan. Now, their set was good, but they had no one in the fucking audience.
Right.
So... to treat me like I'm just another fan when they clearly have no fans.
No, I agree with that.
That is a step down.
Ego.
I run into that a lot
in this business.
I shook his hand.
You're like,
then,
what, do I owe you a thank you?
And then three sets later, when I went on, I said, hey guys, how you doing? How's everybody doing? Like 30 people that I sold tickets to by myself because I don't have a band.
Exactly.
That's right.
I do everything myself. They all came in. I was like, hey, I just want to say hello to... the guys and whatever. I was like, you guys are good. You just gotta, you know, teach the drummer a little, you know,
humility.
You know, some fucking respect.
Yeah, right.
I said, because he just treated me like I was an asshole groupie and he had no idea I was headlining.
I agree with
that. Oh, yeah.
I agree with that.
I was like, oh, dude. I DJ dropped that. And that's
we
it.
Had the same shit. We did.
Listen, dude, every single time T.W.i.N.E. ever played with anybody, I always did the best I could to find out who the fuck those people were.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Always did. Yeah. And I always you did fucked your homework. Homework. Just the promoting right thing. Yeah, the right bands thing to we do. Were playing with. It's not. The idea.
Make sure everybody's working hard and everybody's
Listen,
doing their part.
I just want to say something. If anybody watches this video who's in a band, the idea that the underground has fucking anything to do with competition is the dumbest motherfucking shit you can ever apply to this scene. Because there's another
pump
band.
Pump your brakes. That's not true at all.
It is
stop
true.
It right there.
It
no,
true.
That is not true. That is not true at all. There is absolutely competition, and you're a fool if you don't admit it.
No,
I mean, everybody
I
wants
do
to
some
shine
scales,
hard
I'm like,
and
do
their
do
thing.
Two scales.
Dude, I mean, that's the one thing. Like when you're getting on a stage, secretly in the back. Back of your mind, you do want to blow up and be the fucking band of the night. If you're not, hey, it's no fucking harm, no foul. It doesn't
sorry.
Mean you have to get mad about it.
I apologize.
You know?
If you treat this scene as if it's worth
much better.
The competition,
thank you. Okay.
Then fuck you.
I
How
feel
about
much
that?
Better about that.
Okay.
Excellent.
It's
okay.
not supposed to be about that. And the more you make it about that,
no,
the more
be
promoters,
about that. No.
And the more clubs, the more fucking people are going to take advantage of you because you're going to act like they're doing you a fucking favor by being there.
No.
If you're doing the work, printing the fuck. I said printing the flyers. How old am I? Printing fucking flyer, whatever the fuck. If you're dedicating your
which
time,
which is something that should be done more.
I agree. If you're taking in other words, if you're taking the time to put your life out there to sell a show that the fucking club you're playing for is not fucking fighting to sell, which they should be selling every goddamn thing because Coca-Cola wouldn't take that from their fucking employees. You deserve a little bit more respect than just a band that's fucking
and
playing
that's
now.
Of course.
That actually happened. A quick story that actually happened. We were opening for Blitz.
Never.
No, that's not competition. That's just being a fucking.
No. It's the idea of competition. It's the idea of I have some kind of privilege over you.
That's not competition. That's just being privileged. That has nothing to do with competition. It's just some fucking asshole who thinks, oh, wow, I've been in the same failed band that's never made it anywhere and never gone outside of the state of New York. I know exactly who those guys are. I know the name of their first band and their band before that, too. I know who those guys are. They've been kicking around the same fucking turf forever, and you know what? They had the same attitude when I was your age, so.
It's a big respect factor that I think that everybody that's a part of the scene should have, even whether you're a promoter, you're some form of producer.
If you guys already played your set, right?
Exactly.
You did your thing. How is that competitive in any way?
No.
How is kicking your drums over after you already did your thing? I mean, you played your set. You guys rocked the house. You did your thing. They're getting ready to get. That has nothing to do with being competitive. It's just him being a fucking dick to you.
And they were not
around
before our set was ended.
And that's fucking shameful.
It's
shameful for dudes. For dudes who are still getting paid to go up there and play, good for them. I'm not knocking them. You know, hey, if that's how you want to be, that's how you put whatever, you know. But, I mean, for dudes who are still getting paid to go up there and play, to treat the guys who are busting their ass, coming in young, cutting their teeth,
and just fucking beat their equipment around like that, dude. In my like when we first did that, you touched our fucking guitars, we'll break them over your fucking face. And if I touched somebody else's shit, they'd have done the same thing to me. You know what I mean? Like that's really. I can't believe that guy did that to your shit.
I want to reinforce. I shook his hand and I said, "All right, well, I hope you have a great set." I took me and my fucking 80 fans and I bounced.
Yeah, that was it. They had nobody,
I was like,
right?
"I hope you have a great set."
Best fucking revenge you ever could have got.
I heard that they had a fucking like 10 people in their crowd, and that was it. They had them,
and that's why they got 10 people in their crowd.
Let him. By the way, he's been trying to break in for a while.
I'm sorry.
I want to reinforce a story about the Brighton that I think is very relevant to what we're talking about.
And we play at the Brighton a lot. They take our shit.
The Brighton Bar. I was at the Brighton Bar 3 or 4 weeks ago. This is really recently. And I watched a band that drew 14 people. Like, the place was dead. It was a Thursday night. It drew 14 people. But you know what? All the staff at the Brighton gave the same respect that they would give to any other band. They said that they were, you know, hey, you know, thanks for coming out, guys, this and that, the other thing. And they helped them out, and there was no issues whatsoever. There was no, oh, you only brought this many. You know, it was the Brighton. It all seems like it's the right attitude to have.
And it is. There was a.
It is a great. It's a great place to play. I had issues with two bouncers. But
right,
other than
but
that, I love the staff.
Yeah.
I love the staff.
Our first couple shows.
I like the staff. I love the owner. He's cool, great guy. I mean, I miss Jacque a little bit, but you know, I mean,
the new owner hates us. Does not
really?
Like us. Yeah, he has an issue with me.
Johnny's out.
Me and my 50 identities are leaving because we don't have coal to do.
Scarpelli's the Italian
student. The dealer just called.
Most people are dicks with one personality. He's good with all 50.
And he's one more dickish than the last.
But
he's a great guy.
Back to the whole respect issue.
Yeah.
It's we've been kicked out of there a total of 3 times.
Which one, Brighton or Pony?
Brighton.
Okay.
Pony can go fuck themselves.
Ah,
we kicked ourselves out there.
That's not the Pony, dude.
Yeah.
That's not the Pony. It hasn't been the Pony.
It hasn't
for
been
over
the Pony. Yeah.
Fuck
it's been
that.
A long time.
The Pony
there.
Is
bad.
Dead. Regardless of what Bruce Springsteen or anybody else says, the Pony's been dead for a long
but
time.
But out of the Brighton, one of our extreme breakout shows, we ended up fighting a bouncer.
Yeah.
And
nice.
It wasn't the one with the short hair
or was it the one with the long hair who
was
doing
it? It was
the wannabe meathead.
He was a new guy and he was about your height.
Okay.
But a lot more weight on him.
I snuck in a whole bunch of beer and I basically was like throwing out to the crowd and
But they were drunk enough to open it on stage.
Yeah, like, you know, my one buddy opened up on stage, and there's actually footage of the bouncer looking at, like, the beer and being like, this isn't our shit, you know?
See, those are the priceless moments.
Oh, yeah,
oh,
so,
God.
Like, I'm on stage.
I hope you have
there's
that
just a guy, like, so they're dragging my buddy out, and, like, it's not his fault. He didn't know that I snuck that in. So I'm like, fuck you, fuck this. I was drunk till I was wasted. He gets on stage. He's like, fuck me. He's like, you guys are shut down. The other dude that was in the band with us at the time pushed him off the stage. He came back on.
Swinging.
My old tattoo artist attacked him. I hit the one bassist, one bouncer on accident with my bass.
Oh, it just became a full brawl.
Our fans jump out from the crowd.
So all
start
our fans
swinging.
Are on stage like jumping on stage, beating up these bouncers.
I'm holding this one back. It's one guy back with a knife, and he's just like,
I'm
gonna fucking
stab
you, you son of a bitch.
I'm not shooting like fuck you.
Just like, thank you, Brian. Have a good night.
So it's like a full-fledged
cheers,
ride.
Gentlemen. Yeah. Cheers, cheers. Excellent.
I had just
excellent
gotten tattooed before that show,
and
so I was
he
like,
just got tattooed.
But the funny thing is, we had enough respect.
Cops
for that
coming.
Place.
Time to go.
We told our friends.
Oh yeah, you
we had
fuck
every single
that
fucking
point.
Friend of ours call, apologize. We all showed up there. We apologized. We added the guy on Facebook. I personally apologized to him, and he had enough respect to say, dude, I was just doing my job. You had a fucking kick-ass set. I just had a problem with that one dude punching me in the face. I was like, I understand. I would be pissed if someone punched me in the face, too.
That's the right attitude.
That's the right attitude.
And he said, dude, when is your next show? I will come out. And I was like, your ticket's on the house.
Cool. Oh, man, I love what I'm hearing.
Yeah, exactly. Because
that's the way people are doing it.
I can deal with the fact that like some guy got treated like that.
This fucking scene like started losing its teeth for quite some time there.
Exactly.
It's really nice to hear you guys going out there and fucking stirring
we don't like
up again
to see
shit.
People just kind of like walk over
the,
everything else.
The
it's,
most
it's,
offensive thing I, you could have ever done at any one of my shows was stand in the back of the room and stare at the bar.
Exactly.
If you were there, I probably would have been fucking fighting with you. I'd probably been yelling at you, throwing shit at you. Yeah, absolutely. No, God damn it. You, fucking
great,
pay attention.
Exactly.
We're doing important things here. You know?
We made a good show out of it, you know, and the thing is that the Brighton, they were pissed at us, man. They did not want us back. But you know what? The fact of the matter is, we had so many people and more people wanted to come. They were like, all right, we can't argue with this.
Oh,
you know, and now we're friends with these bouncers.
Oh, exactly.
You know,
friends with the bouncers.
Oh, they
friends,
love
you know?
That shit.
Exactly.
Don't
you know,
even let them.
And like, you know what? The thing they didn't call the cops on me and Teo. Like, you know, we
oh,
ran
yeah,
out.
No,
that's
no,
not
good.
Me and him were the ones that, like, you know, we're really
doesn't
like,
do
you
them
know,
anything.
It doesn't. It does them no good because if the fucking cops come, all they're gonna do, is be more strict on what that bar is allowed to do.
Exactly.
Disenfranchise
their fan base.
It doesn't help them at all. Like, we've run into that a lot of times where
you,
we got
you
we,
bought the Brighton knowing you were never going to call the cops.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, you were any bar. Dude, you sell fucking booze. You get people drunk for a fucking living and they're going to start shit sooner or later. It's going to happen. The last thing you want to do is call the cops. You want to handle it on your own.
Exactly.
That's how people get liquor licenses revoked and buildings shut down. Right. Last thing they want to do is that. That's the thing though. If you sell tickets and you make them a couple of bucks, it gives you some wiggle room.
Yeah, exactly.
Not a whole lot, but it gives you some wiggle room to where you can pull it off, get away with it, and get another booking and try and do it again.
Exactly.
You know what
well,
I mean?
Well, like, out of our 14 people at the Brighton that was a few weeks ago, you know, he wasn't passing out beer that was available at the bar.
Well, yeah.
We
I mean, honestly, we're the type of band that we like to push the envelope. We like to see.
We
like
buttons.
To see where
good.
We can take.
We
like to push buttons. I personally, I pee on our fans. I think
like,
I think
literally?
It's a respect type of issue. If you're gonna love it,
like you're smashing a smashing a yellow whatever.
It's not on stage. Behind the scenes.
Those are my
I try
favorite.
To get them in the back of the bar, like when they're in the back alley. I'm like, all right,
if you're
gonna
play aggressive music, like that's I think that's what I hate about a lot of aggressive music these days. Because or you know, like you hear all these fucking dudes screaming this outlandish shit, and they do it in the most cookie cutter fucking fashion.
Exactly.
You know
I'm
what
doing
I mean? I want to
like,
see a motherfucker show me that he means it. You
exactly.
know what I mean? Like,
and we're out there to show like. We're not just a bunch of assholes making music just to fucking make money off of it. We don't make money as it is.
Yeah,
like,
you never made money.
I
never made a fucking
years,
dime.
I didn't
make
a
fucking
dime.
I
didn't make money, dude. I put my own goddamn
money. I went to California and back and
exactly.
made nothing. I went there broke, came back even
more
broke.
Broke.
Like, oh,
you know what I mean?
God.
All I have to say is we
all made 12 whole dollars from the last show.
Yeah, $12.
There we go.
Bucks,
$12.
Yeah.
I'll fucking clank to that. $12.
Fucking sold out show.
5 years in the making for a sold out show, and I got.
There's a reason for that.
I almost kicked over Dave's keyboards at that show when they threw me.
And we wouldn't have hated you for it. We would have been like, ah, fuck.
I almost got Dave.
Pick up the goddamn keyboard.
Dave's just kind of like, dude.
Sarah, you want to say something?
This video of me kicking over.
Hold on. Speak.
There's the positions that believe in camaraderie first, no matter what it means. And there's the ones that believe I'm getting to the top no matter what. And a good example of that is back when mindless self-indulgence wasn't blowing the fuck up, before Frankenstein Girls came out and they were very underground.
Very.
Oh, extremely.
Them and Gonna Get Got. Were together. They were like a prize, a package deal.
Oh, gee, yeah.
Now, when they got his manager, Mindless's manager, signed both of them, but his manager's a cock and fucked them over completely. Now, as when I was booking Gonna Get Got's Northeast tour or whatever, dude, at that point, Mindless was so fucking huge and popular, you would think they wouldn't fucking care anymore about Gonna Get Got that was in no way comparable to how popular, at least in mainstream.
Right.
But they did everything they can to get make sure Gonna Get Got isn't allowed to play at shows.
Oh, isn't allowed?
Yeah, well,
isn't allowed.
Don't fucking let those dudes play at your
shows.
No,
they screwed them. Yeah, they did really bad. Yeah, real bad.
But
this is a fucking skinny little kid from fucking Brooklyn just trying to fucking make a way through, and they fucking got him so bad. He got screwed really hard.
Yeah, he got screwed. He got
screwed really. I haven't heard from him in years.
Not years.
Well, hopefully that story gets popular enough to where Gonna Get Got gets popular enough to where, you know, they can rival.
Maybe. I don't think it matters at this point. Mindless is so popular, people don't care about the kind of person who's playing the music. They just say, I like the music, so fuck the politics behind it, you know?
No one thinks of that shit.
No, there's been political stories that have brought people to the forefront. There's been political stories that have brought people to the forefront. No, I'm just saying, I hope that political story gets to the forefront enough to where Gonna Get God gets popular enough so where they make a buck or two off of, you know, what they're doing.
Where the fuck has he been, man?
Well, there's not a Gonna Get God, I mean, anymore, so.
So what's he doing? Nothing?
Oh, no?
No, he's, well, he kind of, like, settled down a bit, like, working at his father's business.
Oh, tell him to grow up.
Yeah, really. But, I mean, at that point.
At least as far as I'm aware, he's
that's
still
what the fuck happens. You look back and you're like, oh, fuck.
Yeah.
Works on random shit, but there's no concrete, like, we are touring, we are playing, you know, we are playing all the time, doing shows, doing tours. It was just, it became so fucking difficult to even get enough people to keep showing up that is like, dude, I have a fucking, like, I have to pay rent and, you know, it sucked. Hello. And it was so shitty to see such an enormous band give a fuck about someone else that's just trying to make even a percentage of what the other band accomplished. Yeah. And they accomplished it partly by walking on top of them. Because I can tell you a lot of fans that would go to those shows went to see Gonna Get Got and then became those fans.
Right.
That's why I say, dude, when it comes to any part of the artistic community, whether it be music or anything else.
That's a business.
Community.
That's the new business. Yeah. You know, what Sarah's talking about, that's the whole new business plan that's in the world.
Right.
You know, it's just, you know.
As the monetary system.
You know, you want to talk about how evil.
Collapses.
You want to talk about how evil, you know, the music industry is. It's what you're describing is exactly the same evil that exists amongst all the financial community and all of the construction community and so many vast sectors of our society that, you know, it's the standard. It's become the standard.
Yeah. What you're discussing. But you know what? What we're doing in that community makes us the outlaws of, you know,
exactly.
Of that. You know,
because we're trying so hard to put everything that we have into everything that we do.
So like,
we have the mentality of both we're going to make it no matter what and that we're just like, there's no other way.
No.
Why?
No matter what,
because every single person that has ever helped us, we're going to take along with us.
Right.
It's not just going to be us. It's going to be every single person that's ever done anything for us, any band that's listened to us, anyone that's ever clicked on
a Facebook message from us, anything like that. We're taking them with us no matter what. So it's not just us. It's every single person that's ever helped us is going to get to the top before we do.
Oh, here you're in. We're not... I'm not trying to make it. I'm not.
You're just hanging out.
I'm trying. I'm just trying to, you know, to be honest with you, my whole thing is on is like, you know, I just want to, you know, just make some good music and like,
yeah,
you know, and have other people be influenced by our good time. Not necessarily making it, because to be honest with you, how far will you get in this business? You know, it's a hard business to be a part of. That's the truth. It really is. And you've been a part of it for a very long time. It's extremely corrupt.
That's true.
To be honest with you, it's the same thing as that you're in it long enough to be corrupt. So why would you...
On this show, if you guys pledge loyalty to another band, that if you guys, you know, if there was a mutual relationship that you felt genuine enough to where you guys can make it, and they can make it, and you guys can make it together, if you pledge loyalty to that band, if you pledge loyalty to anybody, on this show right now, you're saying that you would take them with you to the top, absolutely hands
down. No matter what.
No doubt,
I'm not pledging that, I'm making it.
Well, that's the difference between me and Ian. That's why we work so good together, like... I can make,
if you make
this
a
public.
If you make a no. I'm saying if you make a public. If you make a statement to an individual, listen. If we make it, I'm bringing you right with us. We're gonna make this together. We're gonna do this together right now. Are you guys gonna be loyal to that person?
Absolutely.
No matter
if
they become a dick shit falls apart, I get it. But I'm saying, you know, if you pledge that loyalty to somebody, are you gonna screw them over? Like, that's the discussion before, right? Was that gonna get got picked over? And it you know, wasn't any fault of their own. They just lost their way because of the circumstances. And
not at all.
Much well, you know,
there was
one greedy person.
There was
it was the greed of it. It was the greed of it, right? I mean, you guys aren't getting greedy.
You
know what I'm saying, right? I mean,
there was a situation where we started playing with this rapper. His name is Dave Brown. He was a really cool guy. He opened our show, the whole entire show. It was actually one of our greatest shows we ever played. It was a Thanksgiving show. We had a bunch of great bands. We handpicked them ourselves, and they were some of our really good friends. It was a fucking amazing show. He started off the show. There was three people there to see him, including the band. I gave him my full attention. Anyone that was there, I made sure that if they weren't like at the bar drinking, they had their eyes on him. In return, because I know that he had a shitty turnout, he loved it. He loved every second of it. I gave him the headlining spot to one of our next shows. I said, we have a headlining spot. We're going to give it to you because I can give a fuck if we go on later, if we open the show. Like, we want the people that are playing with us and we like genuinely appreciate to be as liked or more liked than we are. We want people
like
to know their names.
If we
just
like
as
you,
much
we
as they
want
know
our
us.
Fans to know you too.
Exactly.
That's,
so
that's,
we
that's
gave,
that's
him, the, we gave him the headlining
that,
spot.
Know, I could stand by it, is that we are really loyal for those that show loyalty to us.
Exactly.
You know, I'm not going to necessarily say, like, you know, the whole back scratching thing. It's just because, you know what, if I like a band,
it's not back scratching.
I don't care if it's a band or just an individual.
I'm just the hard way that we were
saying,
not, we
exactly.
were the only ones.
Yeah, it's
who were that loyal.
It's like, you know, it's like, it's hard because
you have to be smart when you stick your neck out. And that's kind of like,
no, it's very true. You have to protect yourselves.
Exactly.
You know,
because
what I mean, like, I'm for it. And that, it comes down because you don't want to think of it like that. When you start out and everything is good, you want it to be this fucking free-flowing community, and you want to trust and you want to like everybody. And it's just like one nasty day when you wake up and realize how many fucking dirty fingers are in your pie and how many of them.
Exactly.
But I'm not saying, you know, it falls apart if there's a stinky finger in the pot and shit falls apart.
I'm not talking about one. I'm talking about
multiple.
There's a cucumber in the pot.
Very good.
Very good.
There's
a stinky finger in the pot.
I didn't say stinky, goddammit. I said stinky finger fucking cucumber water.
Oh. But yeah, it's rough, you know. It's
that goes into the whole
sucks.
Making.
It happens, yeah. You know. You try and build something big and something awesome, something that's gonna last. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
And you just all you can do is hope that everybody that you choose to do it with is on the same
on the same level, that that's what they want to do as well.
Exactly,
I mean?
Because business is more of a friendship than it is an actual
exactly,
business.
Exactly,
should be.
It should be. For how we've experienced it, it's been more of a friendship.
Right, but the friendship model.
As far as making it and staying loyal goes, it's you're going to look at it and go, look at the guys who are successful and loyal to their fans. They're the guys that created their own success and didn't...
Exactly.
Blink 182 traveled the country, sold it out of the back of the truck. Right.
When you're bought, like, when you're... When you're signed on by someone else, you're essentially becoming a product.
Yeah.
And then people are trying to sell you. So when you're constantly being tried to sold to people, it changes every way of how you think. I mean,
because for us,
Tech9,
yeah,
he built his empire, his massive hip hop empire that he has right now that is still underground.
He's doing Immortal Technique's doing the same thing right behind him.
But if you went up to, you know, you go up to Tech at a show, he's going to sign something for you. He's going to take a picture and he's going to smile.
And it'll always be cool.
You go up to
always be cool.
Go up to Rick Ross. He's probably going to tell you to fuck off.
Yeah.
And,
No, if he comes out at all.
But you know why? Because Rick Ross's money ain't going to Rick Ross.
Right.
Rick Ross signed off. Ross signed the check.
Sell
and
the product.
It's going forward. Rick Ross's only hope of making a goddamn dime, he calls himself a hustler, but his only hope of making
a
goddamn dime
asshole.
Is you buying every fucking t-shirt on the booth, every CD on the rack, and him charging money for his signature.
Yeah, well, his CD is nothing but a motherfucking urinal cake.
That's when it becomes a product.
The only
that's
way
when
he's
going to
make anything,
changes.
Because he signed one of those...
Well,
end your career records.
And
record
mentality,
deal.
The mentality that needs to change is the fact that, you know,
that's the problem. That's
people
what
are,
happens
people
to people.
Of
they
this
think
mindset.
They're making it when they sign a big deal.
This,
you're
this
not.
Needs,
you're
this
not
needs
at
to
all.
Be, this needs to be part of the community. Absolutely. That the general public should know the mindset of the band. And this should be part of the fans' decision on whether or not they like who the band is.
Like,
you know, there's plenty of solid musicians out there that do great work. All right, but we should, you know, as a community,
well,
I think we
you're
should be
talking
picking
about
people.
TV now.
We should
though.
Be picking people that
well, no,
aren't.
You're talking about the TV
bags.
Argument, though. You're talking about the ones
sense.
Or the TV radio argument now. The ones that are forced down your throat. I mean, it's pretty wide open right now. You have your choice. You know, I mean, you can now, especially with, like, you know, the internet and free, like, stream. I mean, like, you know, you can't own it on your own iPod, but you can listen to whatever the fuck you want to. Like, every artist
well, no, that,
out
that's
there...
A, that's a good progression.
Every artist
that's
out
a good
there
progression.
Can
absolutely.
Start a website
yep.
and broadcast their music.
Yep.
You might not be able to take it from them or own it, but you can hear it. You can listen to them. You can decide.
No,
like, that's
I always,
one thing that music is giving back to us, which
absolutely.
Was not there
absolutely.
Very long ago. Like, not too long ago... That was not there.
I need to
you
admit.
Did not have that
hold
option.
Hold
you had
on.
To go into a fucking store and decide, am I going to spend $17 on this fucking thing? Like, at least now you can preview, you can check,
yeah,
you can
sure,
see
sure.
if it's something that
hold
you
on,
want
hold
to support.
On. Go.
Yeah, absolutely. I agree with that completely.
Things that you can have is somebody who's, you know, or a group of people who are artistic enough to make cool merchandise and the fucking tenacity and ability that it takes to pull off a great show. If you have those two things,
hold on.
You have a fucking chance in hell.
Go,
you know?
What I was saying before about, like, the mentality of making it regardless of whatever, I didn't actually mean, like, that is our goal. I could give a fuck if we make it or not.
Yeah.
But I mean, it's the mentality that when we're on stage, like, we have that
right.
that drive. Like,
that's right.
Yeah. We're gonna make this the best fucking show that we can in the confines of us.
Right.
Like, we're gonna play the best that we know how to fucking play.
Smart.
And the next band that comes on, we're gonna hope that they play the fucking best that they can play.
Yeah,
it's the mentality that everything, like, everybody in a band should at least try to have.
I think when you go into something like that and say, we need to make it, we need to get big, like, as a band, like, I think that's kind of selfish.
Yeah.
To be honest,
but I think you've actually already failed if you start
out. Yeah, I just,
like,
I think, once you go into it like that, I think.
We kicked out of T.W.I.N.E. The quickest people we kicked out of T.W.I.N.E. were the people that were like, we need to
we're
do covers
big.
Of Led Zeppelin.
We're gonna be so awesome.
Yeah,
and it's just like
we need to do shit that makes
you
money.
You can just hear
go
the
fuck
fucking
yourself,
inexpensive
you
know, thought process. That shit bullshit.
Shut
that
the
they,
fuck
you know what
up.
I mean? It's like, if that's your main goal, like. Then, dude, be a fucking stockbroker.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean? Go work at a fucking bank,
bullshit.
Asshole. You know
well,
what
look,
I mean? Like,
listen,
yeah.
In terms of music, I mean, music is the absolute most raped art form there fucking is on earth.
That's true.
Music is the one that, and it's because music can be transmitted in so many fucking possible ways. You know what I mean?
Exactly.
Like, if you want to talk about subliminal mind control or societal fucking norms, music is a fucking, it's a mouthpiece. And music has been absolutely co-opted. Absolutely, from the fucking roots.
Yeah.
It's
please.
Disturbing.
Please.
Like, music is only there like every other fucking form of media. Usually every other fucking form of media, which is keep people occupied, keep people stupid. The amount of, like, I saw this picture the other day of a girl, a teenage girl, taking a picture with Miley Cyrus, and the girl was crying. Like, I mean, just bawling, like, thank God I'm with this stupid bitch.
Yeah,
like, what are you fucking, fucking kidding me?
Yeah,
that
element's always been there. When
and it's stupid. As much as I love the Beatles.
Thank you, Sarah.
No,
thank you, Sarah. Fuck you.
Not fuck the Beatles. Fuck that mentality. Fuck the mentality that the Beatles are the greatest band of all time.
When that started, it was an innocent concept.
No, it was not an innocent concept. Jesus Christ.
Making pussies wet.
Dude,
it was never innocent.
And it wasn't like, it wasn't digital.
Put that on my baseball card.
Back then, you gotta remember, back then, it wasn't like, oh, I'm gonna start a record label out of my garage. No, dude, they were like, two record labels,
right.
Like, and then the government,
right.
Like, dude, the Beatles were brought here by, like, MI5, the British
right.
government, and fucking Atlantic Records, or whoever the hell, you know what I mean, like, that's it,
yeah.
Like, there was no competition, there was no nothing, it was
nothing.
Pure marketing, you're gonna fucking like this,
the screaming
girls didn't
I mean,
know that shit,
and by the way,
they didn't know
it's
any
no
of that
different.
Shit,
it's no different than calling Babe Ruth the greatest baseball player of
yeah.
all time. If that fat fuck had to play the number of baseball games it takes now to achieve what he achieved, he would not compare.
He would have had a fucking. He would have had a
never.
Heart attack.
He would have taken that.
Said A-Rod. Hold on.
He was the first.
Sorry.
Pisses me off so fucking much is that people say they changed music forever. Music would never be the way it is now if it wasn't for the Beatles.
That's
but
for
little do people know there were hundreds of bands like the Beatles in the UK at the exact same fucking
yeah.
time.
Like the Monkees.
The only inspiration
there's
I can give the Beatles is there probably were a bunch, a lot of kids that maybe wanted to pick up a guitar because they ended up liking the Beatles.
And not for
but
nothing.
That does not fucking change
the
face.
What was
the
Beatles? The Beatles' message was peace, though, right?
No.
Way later.
Their message at first
their
was
original
so
message
nudist.
Was, oh,
yeah.
Girl, I wanna hold your hand.
They
so
were
that
the original
was their
in sync.
Yeah, exactly.
Not the original.
They were
punk.
The first boy band.
Yeah,
but they were the first boy band.
But
bro.
Like, how
did
they look
maybe they knew they
were able to spread
their
to make people buy our shit.
Yeah,
let's
they
look.
Wore the same
let's
outfit,
hair.
Had the
no,
same haircut.
No,
I know
they
didn't
have
that
mind from the word go, though.
Then that makes them even more guilty. What the fuck are you talking about? What's that an argument?
That's a total argument.
No, it's total argument.
Oh, good God.
The government says, oh, do this, 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 and we'll make you famous. And they're like, okay, let's buy into that for a little while. But then when we get bigger than the government control, no, we'll just spread the message.
No, I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that.
I'm not saying that. I'm not saying that the government built the Beatles. Right,
that's what I thought.
No, that's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that when the Beatles' catchy fucking boy band appeal took hold, Britain knew we have got to get them to the fucking wasteland and sell.
Yeah, right.
And they fucking landed them in the most dramatic fashion and had them at a fucking sports arena.
That's right.
Fucking did it as big as they possibly could.
And then they compared themselves to Jesus and everybody lost their fucking mind.
By the way, anybody else does that nowadays?
And then we're right. Why do you think? Why do you think there was turmoil among the Beatles? Like, they started, and I give them credit for that. They started experimenting. Sure, they started trying the free.
No, they got balls.
They got balls. They grew balls. They did definitely try. And that's why the band fell apart.
That was the point.
That's why the band fell apart, because they decided at some point they were like, you know what, we don't want to be remembered for being teeny boppers.
Go ahead.
Yeah. You know, they...
I said, fuck the Beatles, that's the point. That's the only point I had.
Helter Skelter's badass.
This conversation is going right.
Yeah. I'm really close with
we are all just sighing.
Who's been in Jackson Brown for years. I mean, that's
oh,
like
thank you. Yeah, and Muddy Waters and a million other people playing the same style guitar riffs in the fucking in the worst possible conditions, getting no money for it in America. But these fucking four clean cut British white boys come over playing the same style, and look what happens. You know, like,
money bought them their fame. That's what ended up happening.
Doesn't it always?
Right. Yeah, right. McDonald's advertises so much because they want you to eat a pile of shit in between a bun.
Why do we have to be so famous?
They're one of the most.
There's no need to be famous. Look, listen. Immortal Technique, okay, sold his first album without a record deal, without any fucking money and no management.
Louis C.K.
I apologize. I think it's 30,000 albums himself. That's $300,000 in his pocket that he doesn't owe to a sponsor, he doesn't owe to a record company, because he utilized all the shit. If you present yourself properly and you do your own thing correctly and with respect for the fucking people, you will make it. Not fuck that.
No, I'm not saying, I don't mean fuck that. I'm just saying.
Louis C.K. is
a good one. Let's keep it to music.
Well, there's a fucking band.
Like No Effects who did it pressing 9 inches.
Religion did the same
thing. These motherfuckers, like, I mean, they were with the Green Day and dude, I like Green Day. I have no problem with them. No problem with Offspring. Like the bands, they're great. You know, play good music and stuff. But that, hey, they saw their cash out. They took it. I have no problem with that. I don't hate them or anything like that. It's just we all know. Yes. We all know what they did. We all know that they went MTV. It's all good. Hey, it's fine. That's what you are now. I don't even hate your band. I'm not gonna fucking pay you $70 to go see it, you know? I can pay $20 to go check out No Effects with fucking Bad Religion and Anti-Flag and a bunch of other great fucking bit. You know, hell no, I'm not gonna do that.
Pay a $70 Ticketmaster service charge.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, right. But that's what I'm saying. So, like, you have that choice, and that's fine. Like, I'm not mad at those guys, but you watch a band like No Effects who people didn't even
like. They deserve
like.
More respect.
They were awful. Yeah. They were awful. Right. Like, nobody liked them, but they just practiced, got better, and were persistent, and just made the most sarcastic and one of the greatest fucking bands to ever grace this fucking planet, in my opinion. To be perfectly honest with you, you will never see a better show. And those motherfuckers own everything. Everything. There's two albums owned by Epitaph Records. They bought that fucking rights from them.
Hang on.
They own everything they ever made.
I'm gonna say something you might not like.
Huge respect.
There's another group who did the same thing. Who are they? Matt Clohosy.
What?
I-C-C-P.
Yeah. Whether or not you like their music.
They didn't start that way, though. They got a major deal to begin with.
What
no
they
offense.
Did was, but, I hate but them, they, but they came awesome up with another try.
I can't get that. No, no, dude, I give them a lot of props.
I give them props.
Like or hate them. Short wait, films, hey, albums, hey, fucking
everything.
I never took away. I never took away.
I want to hear Sarah first.
You still gotta fuck ICP because it's the same thing as the Beatles.
No,
at that point, how is it not the same fucking thing?
Hang on. Go ahead. Sarah.
I was just saying, I don't know if I hate ICP as much as I just fucking hate their fans.
That's okay.
Can we have this conversation?
Juggalos. He hates the Juggalos. Matt Clohosy, I'm gonna piss, please. And the fucking stage is yours.
Alright, come on now.
So.
I'm going to smoke a cigarette real quick.
I don't know. She's talking. Hold on.
I actually did an article about this exact thing on Spooky Meat where I compared ICP fans, hardcore fucking paint your face ICP fans, to Lady Gaga fans. There is no difference. You can't say we're different, we're so different from everyone else and no one gets us, yet there's thousands of you wearing the same fucking shit painting your face the same fucking way.
Sarah, are you agreeing with me on the fact that if you're going to say fuck you to Beatles fans, you can say fuck you to ICP fans? Is it relatively the same thing? On that logic, what you just described.
I don't care if people like the Beatles. I'm saying fuck you to the people that say that the Beatles changed the face of music forever.
Fine. No, I understand that. I'm saying on the same exact logic that you're talking about, fuck you Beatles, fuck you Lady Gaga, fuck you ICP. Is that the same line of thinking there? Is that the same?
Well, I was also saying fuck you to the ICP fans that say we're so different, no one fucking gets us. But it's like, dude, you're making yourself be exactly like all these other fucking
what
people.
Do you have to say?
I'm just waiting. I don't hear an answer. I'm so sorry, man. I haven't heard an answer from you yet. On the same logic as fuck you ICP.
But I'm talking about a specific thing. People that say music forever, yeah. Fuck you, people.
Outside of that,
this conversation.
All right. Let the guy with a hatchet man tattoo speak.
No, but you're not right. Because
I have a tattoo.
She's not even. She's a politician right there. Politician is.
All right.
Can I just? All Beatles fans, and I did it. I don't give a shit if you like the Beatles. I'm asking, fuck you.
Can the only Juggalo in the room speak?
No Juggalo.
Jesus Christ.
Found this in the bathroom.
All right. So, see, that's the thing is, it's like, not every single person that throws on some face paint and goes to a show goes, we're so different and this and that. It's like a lot of people just go because they found something in that music. And it is, and that's the thing, though, the music is different. And it is something like, it's music for underdogs, you know, and it's like for people, like personally for me and experiences I've had in my life, I felt like an underdog, and this is music that has helped me make me feel like I belong. Okay, and that's the thing is,
it's music that they like.
I don't shove it in, and I like I know me, and I can speak for tons of other jugglers that don't like shove it in everybody's faces and everything like that. It's just what they do. It's who they are. Like I don't know, like. You know, to generalize a whole fan base and say fuck all of those people.
No, I wasn't generalizing all ICP fans. I said that the people that say we're so different and misunderstood and nobody understands us, yet
there is a misunderstanding though. Like,
I'll say fuck the whole fan base.
I'll say this on Awesome Talk. Fuck every juggler.
I'm not even asking about the fucking
I'm sorry, man. Because I hear it every day from
you.
I know, you know my standpoint.
You know my standpoint.
All you goddamn jiggalos can go
fuck you. It's a juggalo. Don't disrespect the juggalo.
I don't even argue with them anymore. It's a juggalo with a butter knife. I'm done with them.
A running butter knife guy. I don't give a fuck about the fan base. What I give a fuck about is the fact that you guys said specifically, fuck you Beatles because you sold out to the man.
Fuck you, Lady Gaga, because you sold out to the man. And the first part of ICP was that they fuck you sold out to the man.
They didn't.
No, they
didn't.
They
didn't.
Lady Gaga didn't sell out to the man.
Lady Gaga is the man.
When
they first started out, ICP
you understand? Like, no. I mean, like, when it comes to that.
That's what we just showed. Not right in the beginning. Definitely not right
when
in the beginning.
When it comes to artists.
Let him speak.
They definitely did not have a big right. It took them a long time before they ever got a deal with Jive. It took them 3 independent albums that they had promoted before they got a deal with Jive. And then they didn't like how that deal was going, so they said, fuck you, we're moving on with our life.
That.
And every time they did sign with some kind of major label and they didn't like how things were going, they said, fuck you, until they had enough cash to set up their own shop. And they set up their own shop.
Which is why.
There it is. Yeah, absolutely, man. Fucking A. Fucking cool.
So to apply them to the Beatles or Lady Gaga is bullshit. They are built on their own success.
That sounds good.
Sarah, go.
My point of view as a non-juggalo, that I do see that.
She does not jiggle.
I fucking see between Lady Gaga, just as an example, is the marketing of your fans. I'll call you little monsters. I'll call you juggalos. I'll fucking make you buy Faygo and fucking spray it all over you. I will make you feel like you have a place. Make you feel like you have a place to call home, and then I will make money off of your fucking misery. And that's what I saw in a lot of the. Talking about the people like you that are like people that are like, oh yeah, I like ICP's music. That's not who I'm talking about. That is not who I'm talking about.
We're talking about the people who genuinely are like sitting at home masturbating over dead rabbits, going, oh, I'm gonna kill somebody today.
Fundamentalist juggalos here, okay?
Fundamentalist.
It's a very different situation.
Don't get me wrong. Like, I'm not
going to
deny that.
Fundamentalist juggalos.
Like,
I love it. I fucking love it. That is such a.
I love it because you're lumping it all into the same category, but I don't have a problem with you, like, any band, the Beatles or any other fucking band. It's just the taking advantage of someone's feeling of being in a desolate fucking situation and then. Marketing shit off of it that I have a problem with. It's not just I make music that speaks to you. You know, I mean, when you have a fucking festival, you're like, you guys are all our family.
Does anybody have a charger?
Not but we're gonna show you what that's the thing. Yeah, yeah. Sure you're putting it out there is that no, that whole family thing has come strictly.
Not
from
Woodstock.
Fans.
Not
and, no, that, that whole mentality has strictly come from fans Woodstock. And the energy that comes in that's in the room during a show. Like,
but then again, you could say that about any fans. Like, I'll go out and say, I fucking hate Rangers fans.
Are you Devils fan?
No. I hate Devils fans.
Oh, fuck you.
I hate Devils fans and I hate Rangers fans because as soon as you go into a stadium with them, they're like, yeah, get out. It's not like, hey, have a good game, guys. It's a sport. It's like, hey, you don't have a red jersey on? Your penis is probably really small. But then they go in the bathroom and they have to tuck into the fucking stall because they're the one with the small penis.
Are you a part of this fan base?
I'm not a part of this.
He's a gigolo.
No,
he's a gigolo. I knew it.
What?
No, I'm a Devils fan, yes, but I haven't been to a game.
But it's not
you. I haven't been to a game since 2002,
It's all according to preference of who and what you like, really. It's like, you could say you hate ICP fans, and I could say I hate fucking Rangers fans. It's just like the effect that those type of people have on you.
They're annoying.
They're annoying people. They're the most annoying people.
NASA.
No,
I love you,
Matt.
I love you.
Oh, absolutely.
You're my boy.
Fucking that whole fucking.
So wait. Hold on.
Wait. Like, we can leave this behind after this. But, like, and it's true, because, like, it's not just the Rangers, it's the Knicks too. Like, that whole fucking Madison Square Garden mystique.
It's the
thing.
Bullshit.
Okay. Like, where
hold
they
on.
All fucking. It's like this elitist.
I like
fucking
the Florida Panthers, so, like.
Hey, good
it's,
for you.
It's fucking out there. And as
fuck
soon as,
Florida!
Exactly! As soon as I walk into that stadium, they want me out. Like, I paid my money for a fucking ticket. I'm gonna sit there and enjoy
that's
the goddamn game,
stuff.
And whoever wants to be next to me can sit next to me, but you don't have to sit there and scowl and be like.
Yeah,
I went
to a Devils Rangers game with a Devils fan, and it was at the Rangers Stadium in New York.
And you know what happened? He was talking. Oh, he was all kinds of drunk. We were drinking Jack Daniels on the way up on the train.
He was all kinds of drunk,
and he was spitting all kinds of shit out. And you know what every Rangers fan said? Oh, this guy's wily. Like, they were like fucking with him, but they were like all cool with him. Like Rangers Devils.
Exactly. That's what
fucking,
I like.
That's, you know, the there's the coolest.
Yeah, no,
fact,
I mean, you know,
there's each other on.
There's always a dick factor, yeah, but in the end of the evening, it's right. Not like it's gonna end in a riot. It's not like it's gonna end with people beating each other up. Like, it's just. It's just kind of like
there's certain people. That's it's with
yeah,
the
no,
same
Yeah, no, there
thing.
Are a few in every in every crowd though that have to take it to the next
but
it, fucking
okay.
level.
It's all the same everybody. Like ICP fans. Like, it's not all of them. Matt's not a bad
no,
fucking
not
juggler.
At all.
And
no.
I've known him for a long time. He's not a bad juggler.
Hold
it's
on,
just,
hold on. What do you want to say, Sarah?
That's what he's putting it. He's putting my aggressiveness in very nice terms. I was specifically talking about what he just said. The fundamentalists.
Fuck jugglers.
Every fucking group, there's fundamentalists.
Absolutely, and I'll even admit to that. There's even dudes I see at shows, and I'm just like, dude.
You're fucking. You're fucking.
And I'm standing there in face paint too. But I'm like,
you know what, dude. That's a fucking microcosm right there, dude. Because it's seriously. But like, look at it. Like, there are a lot of things that there's a lot of things that we all want to get. Like me personally, like, you know, like I like. Like, and what, like, we were talking earlier about, like, conspiracy theorists and stuff like that, you know what I mean? Like, and how that term is just so fucking, it's offensive, because it means that if you think you are some kind of radical, like, oh my god, I asked a question,
right.
I must be a fucking terrorist or something, you know what I mean? Like, but that, and that's the kind of thing that I hate about it, it's just that, you know, there are just certain fucking people within every single movement that have no fucking, they have no moral fiber and no quality of their own. They have no actual identity. Like, this is Matt. I know Matt is more than just a fucking ICP fan. I mean, like, even if I saw you full face paint going out, I'm like, oh, that's Matt. Dude, no, he's a cool guy. Like, he's not a complete fucking void. He's not an idiot. I know this guy. He's cool. There are certain people out there who drag every movement down.
Well, it's
and that's every single one. There are conspiracy theorists out there who act so fucking crazy about it. They can't just, okay, listen. Yeah, you have a theory. Yeah, you might have some evidence to back it up. But listen, in this world and in the way that we do things, there's a way to go about saying things. You know, there's just, unfortunately, and I don't like it either, but there's protocol. There's protocol and there's a way to make your point where people can access it.
Right.
And then there's a way to go batshit crazy and alienate yourself from everybody.
Hold on.
And I think what Sarah is saying is that there are a lot of juggalos out there.
Let him talk.
Well, and that also brings it to the point where there are those guys, trust me. And it's like, now I have to be careful about wearing this in... But depending in certain places I go, because if some cop notices this and he click, just for wearing.
Oh, you're done. Yeah, absolutely.
Because we're a gang now. Because and trust me, that shit infuriates me too. Those extreme.
No, I agree. And that's what pisses me off. I've been a part of many fucking movements.
It's like when I got arrested.
And there's always some fucking dick who fucking ruins it for everybody by being, like she said, a fundamentalist nut fuck who has no actual identity of their own. Like, dude, I think the last thing that ICP wants you to do is embody them and their band.
No, that's
I think they want you to appreciate it.
They do. And
they want you to appreciate it, enjoy it.
Yeah,
but when the concert's over, wipe off the fucking face paint, go home, and be a fucking real person.
Okay,
you
hang
know
on.
What
stop,
I mean?
Stop,
like,
stop. Listen, it's almost 12:30. We've gone almost an hour and a half over.
Sweet.
Now, yes.
Best episode ever.
Thank you.
Best episode ever, gentlemen.
Listen.
I can't wait for you guys to come back.
We have another
I'm going to start a band just so I can play with you guys.
Two Tuesdays from now, which would be August 14th. Okay.
We might be doing Danny Ride that night, too.
We'll have definitely some guests on. Okay. This is the final word. This is Awesome Talk final word.
All right, final word.
Now, who wants to go first?
Ooh.
Okay, Andrew, come on camera and go first.
Andrew, is it on? Which camera is set?
It's Skycam.
It's Skycam.
All right, Skycam.
Let everybody talk. Let them speak. Go.
I have a final word.
Go.
The word is cunt.
Okay.
I'll go final word.
Go ahead. Brandon from Negative Track.
The camera's up there.
Final word is...
I cooked it there myself.
Okay. Basically, the whole conversation is about music.
right.
And the belonging to music. It's the fact that money can't really bring you happiness. Money can bring you a bunch of fame, but the fucking hard work that you do and the friendships that you build brings you happiness. And that's basically the final word.
Very good.
And we're all people, even Juggalos. Even Juggalos are people. I love you, Matt.
Very good, very good.
I want to talk to Matt next. Go ahead. Final word. Let him speak.
Well, I had a good time. That's it.
Good. Okay. Yeah. It's awesome. Hey, that's fine.
Who's next?
Stonz.
Buck.
All right.
Ryan.
For tonight, final word, I would say, you know, there are a lot of issues and a lot of things that drive wedges between us, be it Juggalo or black or white or Beatles fan or not Beatles fan, like, you know.
I've got a huge wedge.
Yeah, but there are a lot of things that drive wedges between us, and I think the best message and the best final word that I could get out of this night is that we're fucking pulling those things out and coming together and talking, and anything is on the table, and I think that's a good
fucking
mixture.
Yeah,
I like it. I like it. Yeah. Everybody has an opinion, and everybody's opinion is worth something.
Sarah.
That's my final word.
Sarah, final word.
If you're gonna go for a tall glass of water, make sure you go for the whole cucumber.
Yeah, go full cucumber, absolutely.
Now I'm going to reserve the absolute final word to myself, but Ian, you are the last to go. I want to know, talk about the video real quick, and then talk about your final word.
The video is the song World War Z. I wrote it when I was like probably 18, in my first apartment.
Seven.
I'm 23. It's a cool video. It's fun. You guys will see it.
Sweet.
Final word is rock and roll.
Hell yeah.
Rock and roll. Good final word.
My final word is we're about to show you the music video for World War Z. I'd like to point out, I debated with myself whether I was actually going to point this out because I was sober earlier. But the first like 30 seconds is very silent. That's okay. Yeah. That's okay. Don't think there's anything wrong with your sound. The song is coming. The video is awesome. One thing I'd like to say is, you know, don't be a cunt. Don't be an asshole to the people around you. Every time you smile at somebody at the supermarket, you might be doing more than you think you're doing. I'd also like to thank everybody that was on the show tonight. I want to thank everybody from the Ribfest different cams that we're on. I want to thank Negative Traction for being here tonight. I want to thank them for debuting their new music video.
Oh, yeah.
I want to thank
Jacque Brown.
First and foremost. Jacque
did a fantastic job and restrained capabilities too. We had a fucking microphone next to a cell phone.
Right.
I could, and you know, we all had to hush up real hard to hear her, but it was worth hearing.
Absolutely.
She's very intelligent, very insightful, and if you happen to be in the New Orleans area or anywhere else in this country and you have a chance to read some of her writings or any way to support her, please do, because we can't wait to have her back on
the
show.
Absolutely.
I would love to say that conversation could have gone on all night. It was a good one. It was a really good one.
I would also like to say thank you to Jacque, personally. I would say thank you to Negative Traction. You guys were great to have on.
I can't wait for you guys to be back.
Like, it was a good time tonight.
Totally.
And I swear to God, if there's ever another fucking Twine show in the future, you guys are on the
bill. Absolutely.
Let's raise a drink for that shit right now.
Easily. Next time, if we ever do anything else, dude, you guys are the first on my fucking list.
I also want to thank...
That might be
Matt Hill.
Dangerous. That might be illegal in the end.
I want to thank Matt Hill for his work tonight.
Even though he fucking bitched out in my tournament. Matt. You son of a bitch.
I want to thank Matt Hill tonight. I want to thank everybody who watched the show tonight. And listen, we're going to be here. Look, we know Justin TV got fucked up tonight. We know
And we're very sorry. We're very, very sorry, but, you know, it can't be helped. But yeah, YouTube.com/homebarproductions.
If you watch Jackie's video again on there, you'll find out her contact information. Facebook.com/negative.traction, okay, to check out stuff by Negative Traction. And Hey, look, it's been a good time tonight. We're going to be back on the, I think, the 14th. The 14th. We're going to be back.
Two Tuesdays from now, sir.
Yeah, two Tuesdays from now. Sure. And
we're gonna have another killer lineup for you. We're gonna have a lot more killer content. We're working tirelessly, and we're trying to make this bigger and bigger as it goes.
Ask the questions that matters.
Yeah. And I'll tell you what else. Listen, it's been a good show tonight. It's been the best show we've had so far, even though it's only episode number 2.
No.
Episode number 3.
Oh, wait a minute. Wait. What's the Google number?
Number will be 732-654-2211, hopefully next week. All once right. Once I rip Cablevision a new asshole in the morning, we will make sure that this gets done.
But
absolutely.
We will at some point have a Google number, and we know the Justin TV feed got kind of fucked up tonight. Yep. But the big thing is that we need people to contribute. We need people to contribute. This is
if you want to contribute, just contact awesometalktv@gmail.com. We'll work out some different deal. We'll work out a different deal for sponsorships, food, drinks, a monetary contribution. Obviously, every time we get any money, it helps us get the show to a better place, unfortunately, yes. But that is the way the fucking world works.
But not even that, just intellectual contributions as well, though. I would like to say thank you to the people who hung in there on Justin TV tonight and kept chatting and kept talking and kept giving feedback, and that's what is going to really, really roll the ball on this. We want this to be a full-on community experience where everybody's got their own little voice that means something here. And please check back next time.
And are there any other negative traction plugs you guys want to push, shows or whatever, right?
Friday,
now?
Red Bank.
Even if you said it. Even if you said it already. Said
free
it
show.
Friday and Red Bank free show. And then
where?
At the Fix.
What time?
We go on at 12.
12 o'clock.
So there's excuse about work that you can't make it.
Okay. Right.
Unless you're tired, then you can take a nap. That's all right.
Fixing Red Bank Friday.
Then I want to say
at midnight.
Well, hold on. Go ahead.
What time do you open on Friday?
They open at 7 o'clock.
Oh. Okay. Great.
All right.
Awesome.
So there you go. 7 p.m. at the Fix in Red Bank, New Jersey. Go, please support.
And if you don't
have
work, check out the other bands that are there. I know there's some really cool bands that are there, and it's gonna be awesome.
These guys are good dudes. They're legit. They're sweet. They put on a good show, and
they've been
awesome.
Great guests.
And it's awesome to have them here, and we can't wait to have them back again. And so, negative track.
And also, check any past episodes, including this one, are gonna be on YouTube. / Home Bar Productions, and I'm gonna try to have this up as quickly as possible. I will rip Cablevision new asshole in the morning. I fucking promise you. I am sick of this shit, and it is unnecessary, especially considering
Verizon, motherfucker. I stole this beer from Andrew, and it feels like there's AIDS in my mouth.
It's not from the beer.
It's
from my penis in your mouth.
It's from the AIDS that I gave you earlier today.
So once again, friend us at facebook.com/awesometalktv.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Hold on. Thank you to Jacque Brown from Louisiana for her poetry, for her work. Thank you to Negative Traction. I'm glad you guys were here tonight. We will be on YouTube as soon as possible. And this has been Awesome Talk. And thank you for drinking with us.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's Awesome Talk.
best interest to barricade any way into your home with large objects and furniture.
They'll kill us! They'll eat us!
Barricade any way.
They'll kill us!
With large objects and furniture.
They'll kill us! They'll eat us! They'll kill us!
Almost, almost. I got news for you. It's already here.